sound of hits.
Stream. Thank you guys for being here today. It is a beautiful, thirsty Thursday afternoon here in Paducah, Kentucky, the best city in all of northwestern Kentucky. I can say that wholeheartedly. We are live from my studio, King Sound Studio. I'm here. My name is Rick King. This is my studio. I'm in the corner. Over here to my right is the man, Jack Daniels.
What's up, guys?
Dude, so stoked to have you here today.
Heck yeah, dude. Stoked to be here, man. It's going to be a good time.
Jack, for those people who like don't know who you are, first of all, if you don't know who Jack is,
which is everyone,
no, listen, if people don't know who you are at this point, then they're failing at life. But for those people, because this is like a because we care about all of our peoples, whether they're smart or dumb, tell our dumb friends who don't know who you are who you are.
Well, I'm Jack Daniels, as Rick said. I played for the band War of Ages. Also for the band Hope for the Dying. I'm a guitarist turned mix engineer, like a lot of us, hailing from Southeast Missouri, which is not that much more different than Southwest Kentucky.
How far are you from me?
About an hour and a half.
Right.
So not too bad. Close enough to where we can still hang out, but not close enough to where I have to see you every day. So it's like perfect.
It's like you're my mother-in-law.
Yeah.
Like I want you to be close, but not like so close that I like need to see you all the time.
Exactly. That's kind of the thing we got going on here. So
guys, I'm thrilled to death to have Jack here. And I'm like twice as thrilled that you guys are here because Jack's not supporting the stream. You guys are. Jack's just a big old mooch.
Yeah, pretty much.
But in all fairness, Jack, he increases the level of handsome within the household whenever he's here. I appreciate that.
That's debatable. But
and he's very talented. And he's going to share a lot of cool shit with us today. And I'm super excited about that. Jack, let's dive into this.
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah.
Okay.
So I went ahead and I printed basically most of my samples and stuff beforehand. Just because it's a long process. And usually you'll do that in your mix prep. So you basically see all my drum tracks here are red.
How much different is this from like the stuff that you got that was just like raw tracked? You've done a little bit to this already, right? Like you've printed a couple things.
Yeah, basically just the samples I printed. I printed kind of some kick and my kick room, snare, which we'll go into detail later and you'll get to hear those individually. And then I printed some bass tones, through just like different plugins, basically just taking their DI. And then reamp guitars through some of our game of tone profiles, so like the 5153, a couple different versions of that, but everything else is pretty much how they sent it. They originally sent me Axe FX guitars for the rhythms.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you have DIs of those at all?
Yeah, so he sent me DIs as well. At first he didn't, but I asked for the Axe FX, they sounded pretty decent, but I felt like we could have got something a little better.
Okay.
So when he sent me the DIs, I went ahead. I knew he was stoked on the Axe FX, so I did two mixes, basically. One with their tones and one with my tones. But I didn't say which one was which, just like A, B.
So they just like, you just like sent it to him to like listen blindly?
Yeah, pick which mix you like and let me know. And they picked the one with the guitars that we did.
Cool. Right. Guys, as we like start diving into this too, if you guys have questions for Jack, questions about like the workflow or what he's doing, like please like throw them in chat. Okay, so you got these and everything is pretty much like as you received it.
Yeah,
right?
They edited everything like that. So it's all just raw kind of files up right now.
But they sent stuff to you like aligned and
yep, all the edits were done. Everything was done by them and they engineered and tracked most of it themselves as well.
It's hard to read on the screen. Ty Jagu wants to know if you're using Steven Slate Trigger to print the samples.
Yeah, so I do. I'll basically pull up like just the snare top track or whatever. I'll put Trigger on it and then I'll either load in, and which I'll kind of show you here in a bit. I have some of my samples I use. I'll load in some of like Slate samples and then some different room samples. But I'll do that with Trigger. And sometimes I've started using the new Superior Drummer, like that tracker that they have.
Yep.
And using that to basically, you know, turn my snare into MIDI. And then it works really well. You know? That way you can drag it down. And then you have like complete...
So wait, you're able to take like the waveform that they send you and convert it to MIDI then pull it into Superior 3?
Yeah, pull it in and I'll still mix it in just like a trigger sample, but you can kind of control the velocities a lot better.
Okay.
So that way, you know how sometimes the Steven Slate trigger like on dynamic stuff, it usually doesn't get it right at all.
Yeah, you have to go in like manually. And we've like done clip that. I've done that a lot on the stream where like I've gone to like switch to like a trigger and I've had to go through and manually adjust things. Yeah. It's a pain in the ass.
Yeah, so with the MIDI, you can literally just, like you're riding MIDI anyway, so you can just do the velocities and that way you can get a way more dynamic, realistic drum, you know, and it syncs up to your real drum, you know, that way.
Realistic but, drums in metal, that's like...
Yeah.
Heresy.
Yeah, I know, right? No, you're supposed to put trigger on everything and then call it good. But
oh, okay. Well, that's what I do. Yeah. And if like, as far as I'm concerned, like anything that gets like missed, like ghost notes or anything like that, it's just collateral damage.
Just under the bridge. Water under the bridge. Yeah.
It's gone.
If they can't hear it, no one can.
Yeah, SD3 tracker is amazing. You can also completely replace the kit in a few minutes if your RAWs that were sent aren't quite up to par.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to do a whole stream on just doing that. I think we could. That would be super valuable.
Kind of, I feel like that kind of stuff, you know, you see a lot of mixing videos and stuff, but I feel like the mix prep is really honestly where most of it is.
I'll tell you this, anything that I track here that gets sent out for mixing, I always send a free copy. I always purchase with my own money a copy of SD3
and send it
and
with
I send it off with that.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, "Hey guys, I'm sorry. I'm doing the best I can. I live in Western Kentucky. I've got everything's cobbled together with Radio Shack mics and duct tape. Here's some SD3. Godspeed.
Good luck."
Yeah. We should do that though. I think that would be a lot of fun.
Yeah, honestly, the mix prep stuff is where the more you can get done on the mix prep side, the easier it'll be once you get in actually mixing the song. So,
Taija Goose says, "Too bad your drums are supposed to be blue and not red. One place you already messed up." Well, we haven't dived in, and I tend to agree with that.
Well, too bad I'm colorblind, so they're all blue and red to me. I just try to get colors that I can kind of see shades.
So, have you already ran these through like SD3 or through Slate?
I did the Slate because I did this session, you know, it was released last year, so I've already mixed and did all of this. So back then I was still using the trigger and I still do some of that, but the MIDI thing's cool. So yeah, this has all been ran through Slate and I picked samples. I basically like to pick a sample that sounds a lot like the snare top on here. And then
it's similar.
Yeah. So it kind of match it. Obviously if we track the drums, we can take a sample of that and it'll match perfectly. But so I try to pick like a realistic sample and then just like a one shot sample.
Sure.
And then the rooms are just a couple different room options. But yeah, so that's pretty much all I've done to it since. I went ahead and stripped the toms. And I've seen you've streamed that a few times where you kind of show how you do that.
I haven't shown how I strip them, but I do show that like I do strip my toms.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me ask you this. So like when you're starting a mix, you just got everything fresh. Everything's edited and tuned and you're getting ready to dive in. Do you start with drums?
Yeah. So we can do that right now.
Why do you start with drums?
Well, you know, like our good Lord and Savior says, if you're a house built on sand,
yes,
you know, it's surely to crumble or something like that. Don't quote me on the scripture.
Is that what Jesus said?
It may have been Ron Swanson.
Build your drums upon a foundation of sand.
Yeah.
That's how the cookie crumbles.
Right. That's how the cookie crumbles. So I started with drums just because that's a good foundation for me. And that's kind of, you know, everything gets set to that as far as like the bus compressor, all that stuff. I got to kind of have the drum set before I can really set that stuff up.
I think drums do set kind of the foundation they for do, mix,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Do you find yourself like adjusting the drums after like you start bringing other elements in?
Yeah, so I get like a rough balance of the drums and then it just keeps the whole time I'm probably mixing the drums. I'm mixing a little bit of everything the entire process, if that makes sense.
It does.
But I like to get the foundation stuff because right now if I hit play, which I'll hit play so you can hear.
Oh God, here we go.
I mean, it's just everything at zero. So obviously there's a bunch of room mics, there's a bunch of stuff. So I like to get a balance before I even EQ anything.
You do like a little rough fader mix?
Yeah, so yeah, we can do that. We'll kind of do that right now. So
Taijugu wants to know, do you normalize all your drum tracks in prep?
I know a lot of people that'll normalize them to a certain extent. That way, you know, if they're bringing in templates, everything kind of hits it the same, but I don't. I just kind of mix it how, if I'm tracking it for, or like, yeah, if I tracked it in the whole album, they're pretty much the same because I tracked it. Right. If I didn't, I'll just kind of check and make sure whoever did track it, kind of go through every session. That way I don't have, you know, anything wildly different. But yeah, I don't really normalize, you know, everything has to be -9 or something like that. I haven't really ever tried. Maybe I should. It could be fun. But I just kind of like to mix it kind of how it came in. But first I'll kind of just start. I'll just turn everything else down.
Yeah.
And so we'll kind of bring that up because I like to get the drums kind of going. So I'm just going to hit play here. We'll go, let it play, and I'll kind of bounce around the faders, and I'll stop and talk a little bit about what's going on.
While you're doing that, chat, let me know. So Jack likes to start with drums. I tend to start with drums. What do you guys start with? Like, when you're starting a mix, tell me, like, what do you guys start with? What's the first thing that you guys attack? That makes sense. Always drums, rough fader mix, then drums starting with rooms and overheads. I mean, it just makes sense, I think. Now, Jack, you're working in Pro Tools right now. What would you say, while you're doing this, what would you say is the best DAW?
I don't know. Pro Tools? Obviously, that's the one I'm using. I like it the best, but they'll all work. You know, they'll get the job done.
I think Pro Tools probably sounds the best, though.
Yeah, there's actually everything on Pro Tools. You're able to get 5 dB louder than every
your
other DAW.
Your masters will be louder if you mix and master in Pro Tools.
So honestly, what are you even doing if you're not using Pro Tools?
I don't know.
Are you even mixing?
I don't think so. You guys can fight us on that.
Right.
Chaboy, you're absolutely right. The wee-wee does grow a centimeter with every project you mix in Pro Tools.
So, that's basically that. I mean, they're
so
kind
of like, okay, cool. This is like rough drums.
Yeah, it's kind of, okay. I mean, I feel like it's kind of balanced right now. No EQ or anything. It's not too bad. So after I do like a balance, I'll kind of go through and do phase, which is like super duper important and often gets forgotten.
And what does?
Just, you know, checking your phase. Obviously, you can just check it by flipping it on and off. But then,
sure,
like other things, like, you know, zooming in here, you can kind of see where it's off, you know?
Yeah.
Like, obviously, my kick out needs to be flipped. But then also, you could even offset it like a little bit of an amount to make it even more in phase, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Unless you're going through for like a distant thing, like on a room mic or whatever.
So you're talking about like taking the two mics on your kick drum.
Yeah.
And literally, like, are you going to, like, literally drag one over and pull it more into phase?
So, for this kick out, I actually like, because it's a little bit more of a distance thing. But, like, on some of them, I actually did do that. I think on my rooms, you see here that, you know, the rooms are obviously out of phase. They're going down while that one's going up.
Yep.
Which is like a telltale sign.
Yep.
But also, for some reason, the rooms are ahead of the overheads. And so
yeah,
it's
weird that like when you're like doing this stuff like that happens and it makes zero sense
and
as
it,
to why.
It was on all the sessions. So I don't know if when they edited, maybe they got slid forward because it's common to have your rooms a little bit after the overheads.
Right.
Obviously they're
that
further, they're further
sense.
Away.
Right.
So this one, you know, they were before. So what I do instead of dragging it, since with this record, you're mixing a whole album. And if I drag this room track, I'll have to remember to drag every room track.
Like pretty much the exact same amount.
The exact same amount. So what I do is I go down here to your samples, you can see here. And you can actually compensate that an amount to either forward or backwards.
Okay.
And you figure that out. And I don't know if you guys can see up here on the top.
And I feel like usually like if you move something about 69, somewhere between 69 and 420 samples, yeah, usually pulls things pretty well into phase.
Which is pretty much where I did, yeah.
Okay.
So if you come up here, you hit the samples, and then you can go and select, you know, from the beginning of that one to the beginning of this one, and you can kind of see, you know, which really I use this big transient there. you know, you can see the length of what that is up there.
Right.
And then you can go, what's it, like 100?
You can go, I feel like 100 is a lot. Sometimes I feel like 3 inches is all you need.
Right, yeah. So you can go offset that here. And then it'll, you know, now all I have to do is flip the phase on that. And it'll be perfectly in phase. So kind of not just, you know, flipping your phase on your plugins, but also kind of checking if you could move stuff around a little bit. But doing it with that plus and minus samples thing on the track, that way in every session after this, it'll be the same.
Okay.
You won't have to mess with it. So
I've kind of, makes sense.
Yeah, just for like quickness wise, I kind of went through and I kind of, since I've already mixed this, obviously, already kind of have at one point.
This should be like a, Ken wants to know if he's learning something. This should be like a, is this learning?
Yeah.
Is this mixing? Is it going to be one of those memes?
I don't know. Yeah, so now we have like, I basically had to flip the phase on one of my samples and you can zoom in and see. It was out kind of like we did earlier. Flip that compared to those. And then on my kick out mic and then the room. So you can kind of hear that. Even just like playing back, you can, I'll toggle those on and off and kind of hear what the phase is doing.
So if things are out of phase, like what does that even mean? Like what does it mean to be in phase? What is phase?
Well, just the impact of the drum is going to suffer if it's not out of phase or if it is out of phase. So like having things hit at the same time with the same kind of waveforms moving in the same manner is going to have a lot more impact on that transient. So it's super important with really anything, but it's super important in drums. Cause when you know, usually like your snare bottom, if it's out of phase and you turn it up, then your snare top is going to lose some of its impact.
Sure.
And the telltale sign is usually in the low end. You can listen to the low end and be like, you know, once something's out of phase, you can usually tell. And which we can do real quick, I'll just like, let me go to like a busier section on this kick.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Like a kick drum, that way you can kind of hear it a little more.
It's just a phase, bro.
So there's the kick in mic.
Okay.
Now let me turn this off. Here is it with the kick out. And okay. Then I'll flip the phase on that while it's playing. You can kind of hear it cinch up.
Come
and
back
get,
to life.
Yeah, get tight.
That's a huge difference.
Yeah. So yeah, it's like night and day kind of makes, you know. So basically in that same thing down here with the overheads and the rooms.
Nosman 8 wants to know if you align your snare toms with the overheads.
I'll kind of do my snare. The toms, not so much. But a snare is usually like my compass, even for when like editing, you know, the snare never lies.
Right.
So the snare drum and the overheads, making sure those are good. So when I set the phase on the overheads, they were to the snare and they were good. The rooms weren't. So you can kind of hear it here. So I'll play just the overheads. I'll bring in the out of phase rooms and then I'll switch those rooms in
phase. You're
playing
just the overheads and the rooms.
Yep. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's the rooms out of phase, and let me flip them, and you can kind of hear everything come into focus.
Okay. And that's not as drastic as like the kick drum.
No, it's not.
You hear more in the kick drum, but there's definitely a difference. And again, it's like more of like that mid range and low end kind of sound. Like you hear it just kind of like come in just a little tighter.
Yeah.
And what's cool is like every little bit of that you do is just going to make your drums that much more punchy.
Right. It adds up. And also playing with this, you know, the samples down there, kind of aligning those will make a bigger difference too. You know, now that I kind of went back to where it was, you can kind of hear that coming to focus a little more. So yeah, just kind of checking
It's more subtle, but it definitely makes a difference.
Yeah. So just checking the phase on everything like that, just to make sure everything's hitting together and it's all like cohesive. So yeah, we got a balance. We got the phase looked over. So now
So before you even like, so just to like reiterate, you start with your drums and you kind of set like a level mix.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next thing you do is you start like pulling things into phase.
Right. Yeah. Which you could kind of do that before even, you know,
sure.
You could, but I like to hear it in the context because I don't like to be messing with phase and then unsolo something, and it's just like room mics, you know.
Yep.
You know, they're always those pesky room mics.
Luke Newcomb says, I'm loving this. We had our EP mixed and mastered in the States, but getting to see it like this is brilliant.
Yeah, awesome, Luke. Thanks for hanging out with us, man. An awesome name.
So good, right?
Yeah, Luke Newcomb. I love it. So yeah, at this point, I would actually bring in my kind of my bus template that I usually use, because it basically just has all my sins and everything already on it.
So you do have a template set up?
I do have a template set up. I already have it in there. I just have it on a group right now. But
I probably should. I don't know why I don't.
Yeah.
Like, I manually do it every time. And even though it's like the pretty much the same thing.
Right. And that's kind of what I don't have, like, when you see when I bring it in here, there's not like a set of plugins on everything. Like, this is my snare EQ. This is my snare compressor.
Right.
That's not really what I use the template for. It's more of like my sins. Because even though you may use a different set of plugins or you may treat it differently, you're still going to send it. You know, I'm still going to have a drum bus. I'm still going to have a parallel drum bus. So why not put that on basically just a template I can bring in? So I'll bring it in here.
So I feel like if I were to set up a template, it would mostly just be like I open it up and it just puts like two or three instances of Steven Slate virtual tape machine on everything.
Hey, but at least you only have to do it once.
That's right.
Instead of two or three times every time.
Right.
So you see here, I just brought in my template and it's all the selected tracks kind of shown across the board. And I, you know, pretty much all of them, mix bus, everything's down there at the end. You got vocals here, some vocal buses, and we'll kind of go.
What color are your buses?
I just do them all black.
Where are they? I don't see them.
They're showing up on mine.
Oh, they all look red to me.
Dude, I told you I'm colorblind. You see this thing I see right here, kick bus, right? You guys see that?
Yeah, but it definitely looks red to me.
Really?
Yeah.
Dude,
I don't think they're black.
Wait.
Mm-hmm.
Is that better? Is that more?
No, that's definitely red.
Really?
Yeah, it's totally
red. Dude, that looks black to me. Is there even a black on here?
Yeah, if you select none, then it goes black.
What?
None. That's definitely red. There, now they're black.
Ooh, dude, I thought.
But you just turned everything like onto the left. I guess all those stereo tracks to the left are all buses too, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, it was all burgundy.
Jeez, dude. Well, there you have it. See how colorblind
I
am.
What color shirt are we both wearing?
Mine, I'm wearing a burgundy shirt. No, I can see this is black. I guess also you're on your screen, you have like your colors way more poppy. Like the vibrant thing.
I mean, my mixes are more poppy.
That's true. But like up here, like the saturation, see that?
Yeah.
Like mine's usually like back here. So they look black on mine.
Okay. All
but right. That's really dull too. Like no wonder my life sucks. Kenton, I feel for you, buddy.
Yeah, man.
Well, now all my verbs are usually like a gray color, but that's fine that they're black now. I'm not triggered by it.
We can all commiserate too as we get older, because we'll all go deaf together.
Yes, we will. We'll all go deaf together.
Higher saturation colors make the mix shave off harsh transients. That's true. Oh. Like if you don't have a tape machine, which we don't, what I like to do is I like to make my tracks super saturated. And that kind of helps tame the transients as well.
Yep.
It's the same as having a $4,000 tape machine in your studio.
It's all about that saturation. You turn up that brightness color too, it really helps.
That's true.
All right, so you see I pulled in these buses. So basically, I mean, it's kind of your standard. It's nothing crazy. You got your kicks sent to this kick bus. And then my kick room, most of my room stuff, I just send to the drum bus as a whole. So it's not if I put a compressor.
You said it with shells or with cymbals?
Okay, so yeah, when we're getting down the line there. So I basically have a cymbal bus right here and then a drum bus right here.
Where do you send rooms and overheads? Well, I'm assuming overheads go to cymbals.
Rooms and overheads, rooms go to cymbal bus as well.
Okay.
And so you see cymbal bus, drum bus, and then there's also all these parallel buses, which I have the drum comp, a drum smash, a drum dirt, and then there's just the drum master where they all flow into at the end.
What's the difference between drum smash and drum dirt?
Well, I think there's a lot of dirt on the drum dirt.
Okay.
It's just like a nasty, you know, it's a decapitator and this devil lock thing. But I'll start pulling those in now because I kind of like to set that before I even start EQing because it's such a big part of the sound for me.
Okay.
You know, because if you kind of get everything set and then bring in those buses, it's just going to be like, holy crap, you know. So I like to kind of get all my parallel stuff set up before I even touch EQ or anything like that.
Okay.
So I'll go ahead and like turn on some of these sends and we'll bring them up. Let's do that. Turn the groups off here. Let me turn these down. That way we can just kind of slide them up and you can hear what each one is doing as I bring it in.
The different buses?
Yeah, the different buses. I'll pull up the plugin that's on them too so you can kind of also... hear that. Let me mix.
Nosmond 8 wants to know if we're still talking about mixing here. I mean, it's always a little bit of a double entendre whenever we're doing anything especially between Jack and I. You guys know if you're like part of the stream, like everything we do is slightly sexual in some way, or it's about drugs or drinking or something. Like, there's always a double meaning. So are we talking about mixing? Kind of, a little bit.
Maybe. I don't even know. So I'll just hit play and I'll kind of pull up the plug in here so you can.
I see Slate.
Yeah, I'm pulling the Slate. So Rick and I, we use a bunch of different plugins, and I don't have all of those here on his system. So I kind of, narrowed it down to the few. Because Rick, as you see, if you've seen a studio, you know he has the greatest outboard in the world. So
the best.
The best. Only the best for your tracks.
Nobody has better than me.
It's true. So he uses a lot of outboard, which is amazing. And, I don't have all that. So I kind of have a few, basically a lot of plugins. So I would kind of condense them down to plugins that he owns here. But you get the idea. This is more or less what I use.
Trash dumpster worth of plugins.
No, dude, you have, I think it's cool that you don't use very many plugins. Like, you look at my sessions and it's just like plugins. And then I go to your sessions and it's so clean
it's
and nice.
It's just like Pro-Q.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, dude, this is freaking awesome, dude. I wish I could just use Pro-Q and, mix, but whatevs. I can't, so I need plugins because I suck. All right, so I'll just press play and then I'll bring in this first drum comp, which is just kind of your standard. I'm doing a...
We pull that down just to the middle just a little bit.
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
There you go. We got your little graphic.
I was like,
there.
Do I have heads up there?
Yeah, you
so
do.
So just in case, just in case you guys forget what I look like down here or wherever, over here maybe. There's also a couple heads of me up there.
Which is perfect.
Which is perfect. And then I guess there were some heads in the intro. Maybe.
There's always a little bit of Jack heads floating around.
Yeah, so.
You can never have enough.
Well, so there's that. So yeah, here's this. So you see, I basically have like a really slow attack just to kind of let the transients through. It's kind of just your standard.
What bus is this on?
This is on just my drum comp. So this is more just like a standard drum comp. It's a parallel though, but it's usually the main sound.
So you have a bus that all of your drum shells are going to.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a secondary one that all of your shells are
also going to. Yeah.
That it's just like one that you're like compressing.
Yep.
That you're going to use to kind of like blend to taste.
Yeah. Basically I have like three different sets of compression going on that I blend into taste parallel.
Okay.
And so this is the first one, which is more just your standard, whatever, really fast release. That threshold is just set to I just set that to hitting a few gain reduction, and then we're doing 6 ratio there. So I'll just play that and then slide that up and you can hear what it's doing.
That's what she said.
That's what slide it up. So this is just the kick, snare, and toms going to this.
Okay.
So you can see I'm getting a lot of the sound from that.
Yeah. Do you feel like you ride like the comp bus more than you do like just the straight bus?
Yeah, you can kind of look and see. Well, I guess they're about hitting the same.
Okay.
But it's about a 50-50, but the combined effort, is a lot more.
Command Space Audio says, hey, Jack Rick is giving away his gear over the next few shows.
Perfect.
That is true.
So I have to watch his stream and I get a chance to win it.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah. Let me,
it's like a big send off. I'm going to shut the stream down. I'm going to go move out to the desert, live off the grid for a little while. And then, my ultimate goal is to become a potato farmer and to, go on HGTV as a potato farmer with like a $12 trillion budget to buy an open concept house.
Boom.
That's the plan.
In Nashville.
Nosmond N says, hey, if those two jackheads came from a bathroom selfie, which one would be the mirror image? I mean, that's like asking if God can do anything, can he make a burrito that's so hot that even he couldn't eat?
Ooh. So that's just kind of your standard drum comp.
Okay.
And then I'll kind of show you what the drum smash is doing here. Which usually I use like a...
Drum smash is totally different than drum comp.
Yeah, so my drum smash, my drum comp is going to have a really... So this other guy, you see...
Command Space Audio wants to know if only kick, snare, and toms are going to the drum comp.
Right now, yes. Only kick, snare, and toms go to the drum comp.
Why don't you send cymbals there?
Because I send cymbals into this other one, and I'm about to tell you why. I'll turn them off for now so you can hear a comparison. So the drum comp, like I said, has a really slow attack and a really fast release. Just for the kick, snare, toms. My drum smash over here has a pretty kind of fastish attack. For a distressor, this is pretty fast and a medium release. And so this one, I'm looking for less transient information and more of just like the swell afterwards.
Okay.
Which is why I'll send my cymbals kind of to this one and not to this one, because the cymbals will get kind of too...
Wait, so you do send your cymbals to the...
The smash. Yeah, yeah. And so I'll play that and you can kind of hear it's more of just like a kind of pop sound, which is, you know, cool. I like to blend that in differently. I'll start with just the comp and then bring the smash and stuff in here. So that's the smash there. And you hear all the transients is cut out.
Yep.
It's just kind of more of a spitty kind of sound, you know?
Okay.
Just really, basically, you're just like over, really overcompressed. You can see like it's a million on the gain reduction
meter.
What
do you feel like the smash bus brings to the mix that like maybe the comp doesn't?
Well, like as you heard, if I were to like kind of try to clamp down on this one more, you know, like it's nice and smashy, but you lose that transient information that's shooting through.
Sure.
And so I like to have the best of both worlds.
Okay. So this kind of gives you like a little compressed body and some compressed transient.
So yeah. And so this one you kind of hear less attack on, but more of just kind of the sound of a compressed drum that's really nice and punchy.
Okay.
You know, this is it by itself right here again. And see, when I pull those out, the drums get kind of small.
Yeah.
And yeah, so I just kind of, I get that going right from the start before I EQ or anything. That's just, you know, that's basically just those comps going. And then the drum dirt, that one you really kind of have to set later just because it's so...
I'm assuming like the drum dirt is just like take everything you've got and then just to add that last little bit of grit maybe to help it like pop through the mix.
I'll play and show you, but I really can't actually set its level until we get like guitars and stuff going. But you can kind of hear it.
That makes sense.
Just to kind of get an idea.
So drum dirt almost sounds like a little bit like something being shoved like all buttons in on like an 1176 or something. Just just crushing it.
Yeah. What's up, dude?
Oh, yeah. Dude will come and visit you.
Got the kitty tail in the face.
Yeah.
Nice
that's
cat
part
butt.
Of the experience.
Yes.
Welcome to the studio.
It smells awesome.
I'm sure it does.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so yeah, basically, so the devil lock is kind of the all buttons in kind of thingy here. Has this crush feature, which you don't even have to turn up very loud to hear it. And then the distressor is just adding some more just dirt. And you can hear I haven't gated my drums, so there's obviously a lot of cymbals and stuff going through that now.
Yep.
That won't go later, but I will like send my rooms and stuff there. I kind of use that as a dual kind of room smash.
Taijiki wants to know, does having your bus processing set up before mixing closed mics, does that also give you an idea of your balances and gain staging?
Yeah, because I know I'm going to add that stuff later. And so if I mix all my closed mics now and then I add that on, I'll have to go back and readjust a bunch of stuff. But if I get that kind of set in place now, I can just kind of set it and forget it. I'll adjust it a little bit as we go.
Yeah.
But then I can just focus on what I want to do to the individual drums, the close mics, how I want to bring that in, and not be worried about, well, I'm hitting this on this and I'm hitting that, you know. So I just kind of set it up beforehand. And you see, these are kind of the sends to the different, I'm sending a little bit different levels of each.
Sure.
Like that's the snare going to the drum comp, which is the majority of my sound. That's the snare going to that drum smash that you heard, which is the fast attack, really just punchy. And then that's the amount of snare going to the dirt.
Okay.
And it's kind of different for each one. I basically set it just by turning it on and then looking how the kick and snare are reacting to it. And then I'll set it up and I just won't touch it until I kind of start messing with stuff again. But so far, like, so with those set up, let me kind of blend this dirt into... Yeah, so that's that. So that's drums. There's zero EQ, zero anything on it. Just those,
and they already sound great.
Yeah, like I wouldn't be bummed if these drums were on my record, you know?
Yeah.
Just without even touching them with EQ
or
anything.
That's with no EQ on like the snare or the kick.
I haven't even gated any of the drums yet, which is a big part of like, you know, there's bleed going on in the snare still.
Right.
Like all that bleed.
Yep.
But like when you, and that's the other thing too with like when I'm picking these samples, I'm really trying to get stuff that just sound cohesive to like the whole kit. So right now I'm just kind of going through, felt like we got the buses and everything set up pretty well. So I'm going through and just EQing the individual tracks.
Okay.
Just to kind of get them in a place. And then I'll kind of work on the bus of each of those instruments and I'll start bringing other stuff in. But for now I'm just kind of soloed, you know, just working on elements of each drum.
And this is the SSL plug from, Plugin Alliance.
Yep. This is their new SSL. It's awesome. I've loved it. You know, I've been using it for the last couple weeks. So when I did this mix, I obviously didn't use this one. I probably used like the Waves SSL or, the Slate, but I've been using this one and it's good. It's good. So yeah, just kind of setting up a light compression on that kick-in mic, just kind of even it out. And I'll probably do maybe a little more on the bus, but since I have those sins, you know, kind of smashing it.
Right.
I usually try not to overdo it on the individual tracks here. I feel like that one's sounding pretty good. Let's bring in our kick-out mic.
Command Space Audio wants to know if it beats the Waves plug-in.
Oh yeah, 100%. Like I've used that Waves ever since I think we all did. Ever since we started mixing or anything.
Yeah.
Because that was the one. So, yeah, I like this one a lot better.
Are you cautious not to EQ too much as to not affect phase before your bus processing?
Yep, so you'll notice I'll kind of EQ some of the different top end stuff, some mid-range, but I'm not adding a ton of lows, and I'm definitely not going to high-pass any of these individual kick mics because that's when you start high-passing stuff, that's when you see the phase kind of shift.
Okay.
And that's when you get into trouble. So those things that maybe you flip the phase on, if you just high pass it a little bit, well, now where that phase is, because you basically retune the drum, you know, so it changes that.
Let me ask you this. Like when you're doing like the EQ stuff, do you do it on like the individual kick tracks or do you do it like on the kick bus?
Well, you'll see now. Yeah, I kind of do a little bit on the individual tracks.
Okay.
And then I'll do bigger picture stuff on the bus. The kick trig is usually like a trigger, you know, it's usually like kind of processed, or at least there's like high end and stuff there anyway. So I kind of just bring my individual, like actual mic tracks up to par and then blend those in. And then I'll do big picture stuff on the kick bus.
Okay.
So I will like roll off some of the low end on the kick, but I'm conscious not to do it all on the individual tracks. Cause I know that's going to mess with my phase, you know, all that kind of stuff. So
Alex Granite Audio says, the Plugin Alliance SSL is awesome. So much closer to the actual SSLs I've been on.
That's awesome that you've been on SSL. I haven't. But I like the plugin.
I feel like I get asked a lot, like if I've tried like this or that, and like honestly, like if it hasn't been in like your studio or my studio,
yeah, same.
I haven't touched it.
Yeah, maybe one day we'll be cool. You know, we'll get to CLA status and we'll like sit here.
Get on all the airplanes first.
Yeah, we'll get on all the airplanes first with our SSL card.
Yes,
our SSL disability card.
Oh no!
No, I'm sorry.
Oh no!
But no, that's awesome, Alex.
Yes.
All right, so now we're on to our kick-out mic, and I flipped the phase on it earlier, so I just did this on the plugin. I'm gonna play that and then kind of mess around a little bit. I'll probably compress this one a little more, maybe add some more lows, and then I'll blend it in with my kick-in mic that we just did.
Okay. Sounds really great for a kick out mic.
Yeah, it's not bad. I don't usually end up using a lot of this one. You know, a lot of times they kind of sound like butt. But I know a lot of guys are like, I don't know, get good stuff. But this one's not bad. We'll kind of mess around with a little more, and then
I feel like I get a little bit more of the paper sound out of the front mic than I do maybe out of like the inside
mic. Yeah, you definitely have to kind of duck of some different areas that you probably normally wouldn't.
I like the paper though.
Yeah, it's cool. Blend it in. So we'll kind of use a little bit more low end on this one.
You're gonna get a little bit more low end out of your front mic.
Yeah. And then I'm gonna compress it real quick. So then we'll bring in our in, and then I'll kind of blend that one up.
Okay.
Actually, there's a little bit too in that out mic. I'm going to gate it a little bit more. The SSL gate's pretty cool, but I really like this this debleeder plugin. I feel like it's a really good gate.
Now, is this the one that you're talking about that you said was free?
No, it's not free. It's just really cheap. It was like 30 bucks or something.
Oh, that's not bad.
Yeah, it's pretty cheap. But this is a great gate. I love it on snare. Like it's replaced Drum-O-Tom for me, you know, and a lot of those other plugins. So it's just easy to use. You kind of adjust the band. So like, you know, the frequencies that basically you're wanting to use as like a side chain almost to like, okay, we're taking everything around here.
Okay. This is just on your kick out, correct?
Yeah, that's just the kick out. The kick in was pretty, like, it didn't really need a gate.
That sounds like a sample, right? It's got to be, because if it's a kick out.
Yeah, no.
There's no way you're not getting any cymbals in a kick out.
No, the kick out, I did use the debleeder, but I'm saying the kick in, I didn't need to gate it.
Oh, I got you. You're doing a gate on the kick out.
Yeah.
Okay.
I gated the kick out, but yeah, the kick in, it was pretty clean. I'm going to put a little bit more top end on that kick in mic. So yeah, that's kind of with the kick trig and everything in there. So that trigger is just adding a little bit more consistency, but again, it's kind of a sound match to the actual kick drum. So, you know, it just makes everything sound more real.
Sure.
So now I'll start doing a little bit of stuff on the bus. I like to, for the kick.
This is on the kick bus, right?
Yep. Yeah. You got that new, I haven't downloaded the update of this yet. So I haven't tried the new API plugin.
It's just okay. Let me say this. This is going to be like really unpopular opinion. I feel like everything that Steven Slate puts out, people just like gush over. I think he has some really great stuff. I think he has some stuff that's just like, meh. I've tried the API EQ that he's got in his everything bundle.
Yeah.
And I don't think that it sounds or reacts at all like the actual
like
hardware.
Your 550s.
Yeah. I don't think it reacts like the hardware. I don't think it's like the same. Even a little bit.
Yeah.
Especially like the high end. Like I'll try boosting the high end on it, and I just don't think that it does. It's not even close.
Yeah. So let's kind of go through. I'll show you with this, what this Brit in is kind of doing to the low end.
Okay.
So I don't know if you can hear that on stream, but it definitely just like, you know, you hear that low end, get a lot more
just
present.
Just a little bit more, yeah, absolutely.
And I definitely like how that kind of fills it out. Maybe I will try this. Usually I'll do like some kind of EQ. I like this lift thing just for like a high end.
Sure.
But maybe I'll try that. I'll put this thing on there since I haven't got to play with it yet.
Here we go. Make sure to scoop those mids.
I feel like we'll start with that, and then we'll kind of, as we go, it's hard to set real kick high in until everything else is in.
Sure.
All right, so I like the way that kick drum's setting right now. You know, we did a couple EQing on the individual real mics. Some gate on the kick out, the kick trig I just left as is, and I kind of did some overall big picture stuff here on the bus. I don't really feel like I really need to compress it that much since we're doing all these parallel compressors,
right?
Where that kick is already being sent to that. So that's kind of doing all my heavy lifting as far as compression goes.
And kick typically tends to be pretty consistent.
Yeah, for sure. And this drummer who played this, his name is, you know, Norwegian. So I'm sure if I try to say it, I'll butcher it.
Right.
But he's an awesome drummer. He really did an incredible job on all this. It's like Andreas, I believe, but he's incredible. So he's really consistent hitter, and that made it just way easier, you know, to kind of get. So at this point, I'll move on to the snare. We'll still definitely come back to that kick. Once I get everything else in, I'll usually kind of do some transient designer stuff just to kind of make it snap out.
Sure.
But I like to kind of have guitars and stuff in place for that. So like I said, we're just kind of building the foundation, but kick sound I'm stoked on. Let's go to this snare top here. And I'm for sure going to start by gating this bad boy.
Dragship Studio says, I love how Rick took his SM7 to the booth with him. I'm actually not in the booth. I'm just in like the corner of my control room. I'm literally just like Jack is right here.
And Rick's over there.
Yeah.
So like when we look at each other on that other screen, we're looking at each other, which is kind of cool.
But it does make me want to get my SM7 like engraved, though. I think I should do that.
Michael Jackson
says, any saturation you use needs to be done sparingly, especially in metal. It can smear your mix so bad.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. You got to watch it. But also, no saturation, and then you get a sterile mix that a lot of metal sounds like.
Sure.
You know, no kind of vibe or anything. So there's definitely a happy balance. And we'll kind of add more stuff as we go. I'll kind of press play, and then I'll kind of set this debleeder. This is basically a gate, but you can kind of set the fundamentals of where it's picking, you know, like basically the detector. And it's an awesome gate for snare and pretty much everything.
So what are we gating right now?
We're gating snare top.
Snare top, yep. Okay. Which is arguably one of the hardest things to gate because like it's like everything is in a snare mic.
Yeah, everything. Yep.
That's doing a great job though. I can hear it just like really grabbing it and cutting that shit out. Where like my problem with drum tom is that like a lot of times with yeah, that's insane.
It's awesome. It's awesome. Yeah.
So one of my problems with Drumatom is that like, you know, we did it the other day and a lot of times it will like neuter the snare a little bit and I'll have to rely on the overheads to bring some of the high end back to the snare. And it works.
Yep.
But it's frustrating.
It is. Yeah.
And that sounds like it's doing like an incredible job of grabbing stuff.
Yeah. Ever since I started using this when I originally did this mix, I did use Drumatom. I ran all his drums, you know, through Drumatom.
Right.
But when I went back to prep for this, I listen and I'm like, man, that really did kill some of the top end in that raw snare mic. So now that I switched to this method, I mean, it works great.
Yeah, like everybody in chat's like really digging it. I don't own it, but yeah, like it's Command Space Audio says it's like $40.
Yeah,
it's a done deal.
Yeah,
man.
Dude, super cheap. The Wilkinson Audio Debleeder.
When you have that metal money or that pop punk money, like $40 for a plug-in, it's just like, I'll do it. Yeah. Why not? All day.
Yeah, I got that in the, you know, in the backseat of my yacht.
Yeah, I'll grab that too. That's awesome, Command Space Audio. Curtis wants to know if it's a predictive gate.
I'm not that smart to know what that means, but...
But you know it sound good?
It sounds good. I know with the fundamental, Curtis, you can kind of set the frequency. So based off that, you know, where you kind of set this knob here, it knows, okay, that's the fundamentals of my snare. That's what I want to basically to keep safe.
And that I mean, literally like what you just did there sounds like a game changer.
Yeah.
To me.
So then it'll
like there's a lot of plugins that are just kind of like, oh, that's kind of cool. But like, I feel like gates, like, I feel like any gate that I've ever used is always just really not great.
Yeah. Yeah.
That sounded awesome.
Yeah. It's hard. There's tons of tricks and like everyone does something different, but I like this, you know, I think this works great.
Curtis, find out and let us know.
Yeah. If it's that word you used.
Deep
that's
leader.
A pretty big word for Virginia or North Carolina, isn't it?
Although, like, being from, like, well, at least being
I mean,
from
we are in Kentucky, so
I can't say that much, you know? I can just barely read,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm having a fun, I don't even know what that says there. Yeah, so I got that set. Again, you can kind of hear what it's doing. And then I'll go on to the old trusty SSL.
That's cool, because like you just dialed that up in like 30 seconds, and it's done.
Dude,
the snare's ready to roll.
Yep, don't have to worry about it. It keeps ghost notes, which is awesome.
That's the other thing you have to battle with, like, because usually I end up having to, like, whether I'm using trigger or if I'm using then I, when it comes to ghost notes, I'm absolutely having to automate.
Yeah.
And when I automate, I usually have to still deal with the cymbal bleed coming in and out, and it's a battle.
Yeah.
And if I'm using like drum-a-tom, then it just totally neuters any ghost notes.
Yeah. I mean,
so
yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah. When I originally did this mix, at that point I was pulling my ghost notes to another track and processing them differently.
Sure.
And what I've always had to do.
That's still a pain in the ass.
Yeah. And I mean, I still do that. Some, if it's like ton ghost note heavy, but this debleeder works really well. You're like duplicate it and set up a separate setting for ghost notes or something.
My favorite thing to do is like whenever we're tracking to get on the talkback mic and yell at the drummer and tell him no ghosties.
Mm-hmm.
Then you don't have to worry about it at all.
Yeah, cut the ghost. I'm not editing that later. Let's not do any ghost notes. No matter how cool it is, it's not worth it.
Just ghost. just one shot all the ghost notes with an FOP sample. What's FOP?
I don't know.
FOP. FOP. What's a FOP sample? Let us know.
Google that.
Teach us something. We need. Hashtag make that metal mix slam, bro. I don't know what FOP is. Oh, fucking overly processed.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, yes.
That's true.
Yep, yeah. There you go. Yeah, where the ghost notes are like as loud as the snare hit.
Yes.
All the djent bands.
I love that shit.
All right, so we're going to EQ. You know, we got the gate set. We're going to EQ on the snare drum a little bit. So I'm going to riff on that.
Does this SSL plugin have a gate built into it?
It does. It's pretty good, but I just use that debleeder.
Okay.
And sometimes I'll use, because you can kind of hear, I could technically use this on top of that.
I feel like at least with the Waves SSL, I feel like I can never quite get it to where I want it to
no,
be.
No, I
that,
never.
That debleeder sounds so much better.
Right, yeah. So yeah, you may see me try to pull down some other, you know, but I, for the most part, that does the trick.
That's the sound right there. I think the trick is to get that red light to stay on like 100% of the time, and then you know you're good.
Yeah, if you get that red light going. So the cool thing with this SSL, it has this THD circuit, you know, whatever that is. It's like some distortion, but it sounds pretty cool on snare. I'll turn that up.
What is it? I don't know. It's a thing.
Yeah, it's like some cool distortion, saturation.
Total harmonic distortion.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay.
Totally, yeah, that makes sense. Thanks. A lot of you are way smarter than me. And then, you know, I'll do a little bit of EQ on this bad boy. Or compression here. Double click that and it turns it to like a fast attack.
Okay.
But we don't really want that in this instance. All right. Work with that. All right, let's go in and we'll do similar thing, but to the bottom mic here. Nice. So I feel like that gate, it's a good gate. It's working pretty well. And then we'll come over here, and then I'll probably start compressing for the snare bottom. And I'll use this crappy free Pro Tools compressor. I know a lot of guys that actually love this for snare bottom. It sounds like garbage, but it works great on the snare bottom for some reason. Yeah, I'm digging that. So there we got gate, we got that thing, and then I'll do some more EQing. For that EQing, we'll keep going on this trusty guy because he's working out great. And I'm gonna hit play and then mess with this.
Sorry, I've got my links turned off, Command Space Audio. Sorry. I'll get them turned on, though, next stream. Yeah, Shane, it's the only way I can deal with the technical difficulties today. They're frustrating me, so I'm drinking my sorrows away.
So you see, I kind of shifted, I did basically a high pass on the snare bottom. So just kind of checking, because anytime you change that, your phase is going to change. So just kind of checking to make sure our bottom's still good, which it is.
I think this is really interesting because like whenever I do stuff, like I always tend to like, because I do worry about that a lot of times I won't even like, if I'm dealing with like, I don't know, like a snare, if I'm dealing with like a snare bus, I usually like don't like to do much to the individual stuff until it's at the bus level. So yeah. I know I'm affecting it all together.
Yeah, you got to make sure you're, you know, as long as you're checking your phase as you go. Because some things, like obviously my snare bottom, I want to make sure I roll that off there.
Yeah.
If I roll it off on the bus, I'm going to lose all the stuff I'm liking in some other places.
Right.
So that one, you know, but if I can avoid it, I'll try to do all roll off.
Taiji Goo said he beat me to the punch. I was going to say, he said the exact same thing that I was going to say. He said, I only deal with snare bottom in my mix prep. I delete it.
I delete it, yes.
I was going to say, yeah, I just like, I take it and I just like get yeah. rid of it. And then it's like, all right, we're good.
When you were peeing, that's what we were talking about, how much we hate snare bottoms.
Dude, they're absolute garbage. My favorite thing too is like when we're tracking and we're trying to set up a snare bottom. Bottom mic and we're trying to decide if it sounds good or not, it's like, I don't know, it's there, let's keep going. Dragon Ship purchased the bleeder.
Nice.
Good call. Awesome, Curtis. Yeah, I think, dude, it's rad. I'm definitely gonna get it after yeah. the stream for well, sure.
Technically riff, I'm gonna start calling you Riff. You have it now, so there you go.
Do I have it?
Yep.
Like officially have it?
I think so.
Oh, do I have one of your downloads?
I think so.
Okay,
it's working.
All right.
So yeah, I'm going to take out some problem things in this snare bottom.
Oh, that's the entire thing.
Yeah.
You do all pass filter. There it is. Oh, you're busting that out?
No. This is just on the individual track here.
I'm talking about the BF, whatever it's called.
Oh, I'm busting it out? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That thing rules on snare bottom.
Really?
That's what we're talking about. Snare bottom is so shitty that the shittiest plugin in the world rules on it.
What's cool about that is that like there's a lot of compressor plugins that you can't use as sidechains. Like they're not set up to like,
really?
You know, with like the key inputs.
Yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I've noticed that a lot of them don't have it, but like
this guy
good
does.
Old BF, whatever it is, does have it.
Good old BF76. All right. So snare's pretty good. I think I'm going to, so you know, we'll use a transient designer for like the attack, but I'm going to use it on my snare to kind of bring out some of the length of the snare. So we'll kind of
okay.
pull that up here. That way you can kind of see
And you just crank the transient to like 100, right?
Right, yeah. You got to just... Yeah, we'll leave that. And then I usually use the attacker one for this, but we'll try this bad boy.
What about the girth of the snare? That's the only thing that matters. It's all about the girth. Excuse me. So did you clamp down harder on the gate?
Yeah, so I clamp on the gate, and then it kind of makes that snare sound like the snare bottom sound like it's being choked.
Right.
But it's getting rid of kind of like the tom stuff and like that kind of stuff that happens after.
Right.
So then I'll use this envelope filter to...
Maybe try to bring some of it back.
Bring the sustain back up. So you can hear, I'll play it, and you can definitely like hear it adding more extension to that bottom.
Okay.
See, it's not as choked.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know if you can hear that very well over there, but.
I hear it.
So then you just turn that bottom all the way down, like all that work you did for nothing.
Yep.
And we keep going. Yeah. Feeling good about that. In context of everything. And so this is our trigger. Basically, it's kind of a match to our top. It's a little bit different pitch, but let me go to like a different part of the song too. So I'm not just like staying on this part the whole time. We got like more snares. There we go. Yeah.
There's that ping.
It's a sample, but it's got a little more note to it.
Yep.
Shout out to Bo.
Virtual?
Yeah, dude. These are some of his samples. We got that pack there.
Which one are you using?
I think it's the Era and maybe a couple. It's one or two of his and then one, I think one of ours kind of blended together.
Okay.
But yeah, it kind of matched this drum. The pitch is a little different.
Right.
Like in retrospect, I probably should have used the pitch knob on trigger to pitch this one up just a little bit. But I feel like the phase is tight. And so I actually didn't use this on the actual mix because obviously these samples like weren't out yet.
Right.
And so when I was doing this mix prep, I thought, no, I'll try something new just to kind of...
I do like a lot of the Bose samples though.
Yeah.
And might as well just try something new.
Yeah. And I feel like they're cool. Like where Slate stuff's all like pretty processed. Like Bose samples are like pretty like raw, you know, they got like a good natural sound. So they're a good starting point to like blend in with real drums.
Sure.
Cause you get some really
well,
real
the nice drums. Thing is those samples are real drums too.
Right. Exactly. Know? Yeah. Just like when we make them here, when we record our kits, like we're able to sample and then make trigger files of that.
Absolutely. Which I covered a little bit yesterday. I want to do another stream on that too, specifically. Chris TGI.
Dang.
Thank you for the sub, buddy. Tier one. Appreciate it. Enjoy your Rickhead emote, man. Cheers to you, buddy. It's like I got a Modelo.
I got some nitro cold brew.
Nice.
Yeah.
Keeping it for non-alcoholic for the stream.
Oh no, there's definitely some whiskey.
You drop a little bit in there. Chris, welcome to the Stewed Crew, buddy. Thank you so much. Appreciate the Twitch Prime sub, buddy. You are the man.
Chris is awesome. For all you guys, go check him out at Ironfoot Audio.
Yes.
He does some sick stuff. He just sent me some songs that he's producing for a band up there, and I did some reamps for him, and it sounds killer. He's doing some awesome stuff. So
awesome.
Ironfoot Audio, all you guys watching, go hit him up on the old Instagram. Heck yeah. So we're going to keep on rolling here. So I got my snare, like I said, we just showed you that kind of sample. I'm going to EQ it just a little bit, but I'm not going to, I really like how it's sitting with it by itself. So I'm just going to bring out a little, like some high end and then kind of do some big picture stuff of everything.
Okay.
Ooh. Didn't want to do that. Kind of take out some of that ring. It's getting a little crazy.
Okay.
All right, and I feel like that's gonna be, this other sample is just like a one shot. Yeah. Just really sample-y sounding sample.
Sounds like drums though.
Yeah, yeah, so that is just kind of a, it's a slate sample, but I'm gonna kind of just bring that a little loud there.
Yeah.
A little cooking.
We're just getting a little feedback from
Yeah, a little feedback. Never heard anybody.
I had to stand up and stretch the old legs anyways.
Oh yeah. All right.
That's my problem with mixing. I can go about 30 seconds before I gotta stretch my legs and watch an episode of Dr. Phil. So I never get anything done.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard to.
Yeah.
All right, so there's our... now we'll start doing some like bigger picture stuff on the snare. Similar with the kick. And for now, I'll bring in this guy. Kind of the same kind.
I always get a little jazzed every time I see the what is it? The VMS? VMR? What is it?
Yeah, VMR. VMR.
VMR.
Virtual mix rack. Yeah, you know, right. Things are about to get real.
It's about to get really real.
So we'll do that that same Brit in. We'll kind of move the drive up. Yeah, sounded pretty good. And then I'll use this. I'll usually go to this lift just to kind of bring out some more top. And then some of the punch. I feel like we could even do a little bit more kind of 200 kind of low impact on that snare. Bring out this guy, try him out. Nope. Let's try.
I told you.
Hey, not everything can work for everything.
I know.
I think if I back it off here too. But I want something with a roll off because I want to kind of roll everything off a little bit if I'm going to boost that much 200.
Sure.
Or kind of in between there.
Taija, is that on the API one? It says you can hold down shift and make it not stepped.
Oh, nice. That's cool. No, I know that.
I still don't like it.
Well, I probably would. I probably could make it work, but like I said, the roll off I'm going to add anyway, so might as well use an EQ with one.
Yeah.
See kind of what it's adding to the snare. Just a little more excitement.
Yep.
And then usually I'll compress it a little bit on its own. Just kind of everything.
This is on the bus, right?
Yeah, on the bus of that snare.
Okay.
We can try this thing. Kind of kissing it because I am, like I said, I got all those other parallel drum sends.
Right.
And then we'll kind of do the same thing with the transient designer, but after I kind of get some more stuff in there.
The API either works or doesn't sound good to me. I don't really understand the hype though. Yeah, that's what I'm saying, man. I feel like, and I'm not out to like trash talk anything. I just speak from my own personal experience. I have a couple of 550Bs in the studio and a 5500, which I love for drums. And I use it on my drum bus and I feel like I get a lot of love out of it. And I just feel like as I twist those knobs compared to like the knobs and I don't even know that, like, I don't think that like the frequencies quite match perfectly like a 550B. Like I know there's four knobs on there, but it's like a 550A with, if I'm not mistaken. The API, the slate one, is like a 550A with like but like one of the knobs is doubled, so you have a little bit more control. And I don't think it's the same on the 550B. I could be wrong on that. But yeah, I feel like the curves seem weird. I agree, man. Like I twist it and I pulled it up multiple times to like check it out. And for me, as I twist it, I'm just like, eh, I don't think this is the same at all. Dragonship Studio says, I'll use an analog 550 on anything. I keep my A's across my drum bus on the reg. Dude, I totally agree. There's something about like legitimate API 550s on a drum bus that just does something cool and nice. And, I think like probably like some of the UAD stuff, I haven't used it, but I assume that the UAD stuff is probably great. I feel like the Slate API emulation is just not there personally.
Yeah. I don't know. I love tracking with yours here when we do drums, but I haven't mixed with any other than the Waves plugin, and then obviously now that one. But yeah, so we'll kind of move on to toms, and I'll do just a little bit of kind of EQ on each tom.
Anybody that's been following me this week too will tell you, at least the last couple weeks, as I've been mixing some stuff, they'll tell you, like, me and toms, we don't get along super well. I feel like my toms are either like way too loud or they're too quiet. I can't find a happy medium. I just feel like they're this weird thing.
Yeah. What I've been doing to kind of help, because in the mix, like once you get to mastering, they either squash everything and you get crispies,
right?
Or they're not loud enough. So I'll usually like put a limiter on my toms.
Okay.
And just keep them pinned.
Okay.
You know, do a little bit of compression too, but it helps once they get to that, you know, just helps them kind of sit. But oh yeah, let's EQ this bad boy.
I'll tell you one of the things that I think helps too is I feel like all these sound like it was tracked really well.
Yeah. Yeah, he did
a
good job.
Raw tracks sound really good.
Yeah. So these toms I did actually cut in a sample with them and bounce that when I did the cleanup. But yeah, for the most part, all the clean sound. And I kind of did the same thing where I just picked a tom sample. I don't even know which one, but it matched his drum sound pretty well.
Okay.
But you can still hear some of the bleed that I cut down. Like they still just... You know, when he's hitting cymbals, like you still hear all that.
Yeah. Uncle Jesse says, I missed the old URS A-Series EQ from over 6 to 7 years ago. They changed it and the magic left, but they used to be the closest to the 550Bs, in his opinion, even today. I mean, we just can't have nice things. That's just all there is to it.
This is why. So with that, I'm just kind of getting rid of some of the boxiness.
Yep.
I usually roll up a little higher on my high tom, not a ton of low end, and then have a little more, you know, once we get to the low tom there. So I'll just bring this guy down and then adjust it.
Yeah, Kenton, I feel like the Fab Filter Pro Q is kind of like a desert island EQ. We talk about that a lot here. I feel like you can like if you only had one EQ, I feel like that should be the EQ. It's great for sculpting. It's great for like surgical stuff. It's really an awesome EQ. It's not the cheapest one in the world, but man, like you see me, I use it constantly.
This one sounded a little bit more papier compared to the high tom.
Yeah, Dragon Ship, I'm waiting for like a Christmas special when all the Pro Q stuff or the Fab Filter stuff goes on sale as a bundle, and I'm just gonna last year I grabbed Sound Toys, this year I'm gonna grab like whatever I can. I'm waiting for the sale for everything Fab Filter. I want the whole thing.
Yeah, same. I want their multiband.
Yes.
I did the trial of that, and like I almost bought it, but I was just like, man, it was awesome though.
Yep,
I'm just waiting for the sale because the plugin on its own was like $300. But if you wait till like Christmas, you can get like their whole bundle for like that, basically. Or at least like different mixing or mastering bundles. So,
yeah, I'm definitely interested in the de-esser as well on it. It's true. Curtis says like with Sound Toys and Fab Filters, like you could pretty much mix everything with just those.
Oh yeah.
I totally agree. That's literally like all you would need.
All right.
Yeah, their multiband does kill. Everything Fab Filter does is like, I agree with Curtis. I think if you have if you have the Sound Toys bundle with all like the fun stuff that comes with that, with the delays, the saturation stuff, like all that cool shit, and then you have like the Fab Filter bundle with like the multiband compression, the de-esser, the limiter, the EQ, like the reverb even, like you're gonna have everything. You're set.
All right, so we got the little bit of individual EQ on these toms. Each one done a little differently. I feel like that floor tom had this little kind of papery thing, so it has a bigger dip there and not as much low end. So I just kind of balance those out and positioning of their low end. So the high tom, you know, has its peak, and then the low tom has its peak a little lower. And then we'll go down here to the bus. Again, I'll put this, I love this thing on drums. Just the low end of it is awesome.
You know, what's interesting. I feel like what you're getting out of the virtual channel there with the Brit, I feel like I get the same thing from the 542s.
Yeah. Urban Eve stuff. I bet. Yeah.
I feel like it's bringing like that same amount of like punchiness and like low end, like
just, absolutely.
I feel like that's what's doing it for me.
Yeah. But I'd love to get that for like the drum bus, you know?
But I think it's cool that like even with something like this, like you can still achieve like the same thing.
Yeah. There's what that EQ's doing, just a little bit more high end. And then we'll,
that sounds great.
Yeah. Kind of doing some sculpting, and then this thing's pretty good for just like a standard compressor. Kind of find some single hits. So you kind of hear what that is all doing together.
Yeah.
And then we'll do the transient designer. Bring out some more stick in this. So this thing's weird. It says that I'm at like 800.
Yep.
I feel like it's a little higher than what it says, because that's not usually where your stick is at.
Right.
But, you know, I don't know. But you just kind of use your ears. I usually go above with the attack and then dial it back, which I find the frequency. So this is like a multi-band, you know, transient designer.
Taiji Goose heading out. Got to slam a client mix and eat pizza. Fuck yeah, dude.
Nice, dude.
Enjoy the pizza. Good luck on the mix, man. Yeah. Thank you for hanging today. I appreciate you like hanging out and then participating. Go have a good one, buddy.
Yeah, dude. Thanks for sticking around. It's kind of annoying. There you go. Let's bring out a little attack, and then let's set those kind of in the mix of the drums here. And I'm using this makeup because, God forbid, this 00 goes into the plus. That is a...
That's breaking a cardinal.
You can't, yeah, I cannot like just turn this up here.
No.
So I have to go to a plugin and then turn it up. I can go down, but I can't have any fader above zero. Your mix will fall apart.
I mean, you've already got stuff that's like slamming into like the soft clip.
Yeah.
That's already stressing me out to no end.
Dude, yeah. By the end, it doesn't even matter.
I know.
It's silly.
If you hit the yellow, it's just adding saturation, right? Yeah.
There's really no way, you know, to clip it. I mean, I guess you can. You can clip the converters, but like that soft clip thing doesn't really mean much in Pro Tools now.
Sure.
It used to. All right, feel like times are pretty good. Let's work on these overheads. All right, so I'm gonna do the old trusty this EQ, as you see coming up a lot today. Yep. All right, so here we are. We're just gonna EQ these overheads, get them dialed in. Just kind of pulling out some of the boxiness. And then I usually high pass them pretty. I'm not getting a lot of kit sound. Just kind of making sure, you know, everything's in there for the most part. So I'll kind of do broad strokes with this. And then I'll go to basically the Pro Q here. And we will kind of get some of the more crispy stuff that's bugging us. So I'm going to play that and go through. I may go to like a different section here. See. do yeah, not too bad. Keep playing that section. Trying to pull out some of those sections where the ride hits and you kind of hear it get a little harsh in the overheads. There's like a lower one too I'm going to try to grab real quick.
I'm back.
So yeah, we kind of got that going, and then we'll set up our rooms here. Start with the same channel, and then I'll smash these a little more too, but we'll start kind of EQing here. So you kind of hear the difference when I pull that off and they come out of phase and everything gets fuzzy.
Maka Audio wants to know, did you use linear phase on the overheads at all?
No. Well, I think we're just in the regular Pro Q mode.
Yeah.
I know there's a way to switch it to linear phase, but I don't know. Usually I will use the Q10 on this because I don't have Pro Q. I think Q10 is like the Waves plugin is a linear phase. We can turn it on and kind of hear. Yeah, usually Q10 will have it on there. I just didn't switch this plugin over. Keeps everything nice and tight when you go cutting stuff out. And then, all right, back to the rooms. Let's pull up our classic virtual mix rack here.
There she is. You know it's about to get real.
Yeah, do some, since we're going to squash these rooms.
Bringing the bomber out.
Yeah, dude.
Okay.
Bring the bomber.
I like the bomber a lot.
Yeah, the bomber's awesome.
It is. It's super cool.
Bring the bomber over here.
I don't know anything that does like what the bomber does.
Yeah, it's an interesting plugin. It's fun.
Like, it's kind of a compressor, but also kind of not.
Yeah. And the old monster.
Yeah, man.
This thing's just crazy. And I'm actually going to pull out a little bit of that ride cymbal. It's so loud and everything when he crashes on the ride a lot.
So I use the monster a lot on like a parallel snare.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like that does, like, I think it's pretty rad there.
Nice poppy.
Anything that needs like slam, though.
Right. It's fun. Seems like we got a little big guy a little lower too. So that's where that like soothe plugin is pretty cool.
Sure.
When you get that, is because it'll basically only turn on when that kind of stuff is happening.
Mm-hmm.
So you can kind of set, it's like a multi-band.
Instead of just being like static.
Yeah. But it's not like a multi-band compressor. It's like a multi-band notch EQ weird thing. Yeah.
Sure.
So like where that, now that dip I made is kind of over everything, which there is some buildup of that everywhere, but it's really apparent in those sections. So you could kind of have that just kind of doing it only when it needs.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Otherwise, you have to like automate. If you really wanted to, you go through and automate all that stuff. But yeah. That just seems like a nightmare, especially across an album.
Yeah, exactly. So we'll end up bringing that into the bus there. So, hold on, let's just hit the hat and ride real quick.
I think what's really interesting, Ken says he's learning a lot. I think what's really interesting is like how much more processing you do than I do. Like I rely so much on like, we have like totally different approaches and I love that because, I feel like you're going in and like, you're really diving in and like sculpting every little thing. And I think that like really shines in your mixes. And like, I like don't have the attention span for it. So I'm just like, let's just slap this on a bus. And then let's just like EQ that whole bus until it sounds cool and usable. And I appreciate like the totally different like style.
Right. Cause there's something to be said about that too. Like where yours, it's more of like an art, you know, like you're just making quick decisions based on everything. And some of it, you know, may not need to be looked at. You know, there's, you know,
well, I think I could definitely be better at what I do if I took more of like an approach that you do. I think I get caught. So like, I'm in this weird spot where it's like, I feel like things get so processed that like, I just want to like not process everything.
Yeah.
And I want to like, I love during the tracking process, really finding a band's sound and trying to stay true to that and letting things be what they are.
Yeah.
But sometimes when you do that, sometimes like, it's just not very good. You know, and so like you do, and I just think it's like, it's cool to see like a totally different approach. Like the guys that have been following me on this stream, you guys will see like I spend way less time doing this stuff. And it's just kind of like, this is what it is. Let's just make this sound like the best version of this that it is. And you're really going in there and like, just really diving in and making sure that like, everything sounds great. And I love, I feel inspired by that. I think that's super cool.
Yeah. I appreciate that. I think it's good to be mindful of both approaches and kind of, you know, definitely employ them when you can.
I mean, I feel like mine's the best way to do it.
Right, obviously. If anyone needs to employ anything, I need to work on more of what you're doing.
No.
Not vice versa.
Well, I think it's different too, because it's like totally different styles.
The styles,
I feel like with metal, like it's not about being, I don't know what the term is. It's not about being like natural and like going with the feel of things. And
yeah, I don't know.
With pop punk either.
Yeah, I feel like you definitely have to have that natural element. Like I'm not changing what is there. I'm just pulling out stuff that bugs me, you know, and like you can definitely overdo that and cut too much out, but
which I think I'm guilty of a lot. And I think maybe that's why I'm scared of it quite a bit, because I know when I do it, I go overboard with
it. So it's good to, you know, and also I'm still in like solo in the drums,
right?
And so it, you know, typically at this point I'm out of solo or out of the drums as far as mixing goes,
right?
But like having to explain it, you know, so it's taking a little bit longer. But yeah, I'm almost like, I just kind of cleaned up the ride, cleaned up the hat. We'll kind of just do a quick guy on the ride here. I mean, it's a ride.
Cause like if I'm processing a ride, like I'll go through and I'll just like pull out frequencies I don't like, and then I'll just ride the fader. And that's. But so I appreciate like the care and detail that you're giving to like each individual thing.
For sure. Okay. So now we kind of have, everything kind of has its own little bit of glue on it, more or less.
Shane, this is a session that was previously mixed.
Yeah, I mixed this last year.
It's out right now.
Yeah,
and
it's released.
Awesome.
The band is Fleshkiller. Definitely go check out that. This is kind of like a remixing of it, going back with what I did. So at this point, usually I would kind of probably already put my bus stuff on.
Right.
But I'll do that now.
I can tell that like each thing that you're doing adds like, it's not about like one swift move that like makes everything sound better. It's all little
5%,
like 2-5% things that are making things sound better and better and better. So by the time that you start adding up, like get to the mix phase, they've all compounded on top of each other. What's the name of the song that we're doing?
Window of Time.
That's epic as shit.
Yeah, dude. Window of Time.
Wow. That's the cool thing about metal too, is they always have, everything's fucking epic.
Right. Where's your, I guess you don't have the tape machine on here, do you?
What, virtual tape machine?
Yeah.
I mean, it should be, but maybe I might have gotten rid of it.
Oh, maybe I'm in the wrong thing. Maybe if I go to, yeah, there it is. There it is. All right. So we'll play with this on the drum bus.
There she is.
So this thing always adds a ton of low end.
Yep.
But if you go into the settings here, it has this bass alignment.
Oh no.
And you can use that to basically just slide it, you know, kind of offset some of the massive low end this thing is adding.
That is better.
So I feel like the cymbals are just a little bland still, but I kind of did my individual processing. So now I'm going to go to the cymbal bus. And I like to add this Verimu thing, which, Rick, you track overheads with through yours, don't you, usually?
What, through the Verimu?
Yeah.
I do, just because I like to, like, keep them a little under control.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like, especially because I think, like, whenever we track drums, you know, we have things... our overheads aren't like parallel with each other. We try to keep them equidistant to the snare.
The snare, yeah.
So sometimes one cymbal can be like on the right side can be a little bit louder than the left. I guess my hope is to just kind of like bring that in a little bit.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yep, for sure.
And just overall, just to kind of like keep things even keel.
Right. Yep. So yeah, I just like the color of it. You know, like just leaving the plug-in on and just turning up this mix knob without compressing anything, you'll just hear a nice kind of shine added to it.
Okay.
It'd probably help if I sold the cymbals, because you probably can't hear it on stream, but I can hear it out here. Yeah, just kind of lifts it up a little bit, and then I'll do a little bit of compression here as well. And then also, if you turn that stereo link off on overheads, it kind of gives that little bit of pull between each side,
yep.
Which is kind of nice. You know, when he hits this crash or something, it kind of
it doesn't duck push the and pull. Other side,
yeah, yeah. Anything. It's kind of gives more movement to the drums. Typically, I'll also do like a multi-band compressor on there as well, because you can kind of on the overheads, you can kind of pick certain elements and like just kind of compress the hi-hat or something by picking its frequency range. But I don't think we have one.
Oh, we have some. None that I love.
None that you like, yeah. Yeah, I think that Fab Filter one is definitely awesome for that.
It's on the list.
Yep. All right, let's bring in our thingies back. So I feel like I'm to a point where I'm just going to go ahead and turn some of these verbs on that I'm sending to.
Okay.
But we'll dial them in because I'm going to start bringing in guitars and stuff. I'm tired of listening to just drums now. I'm sure all of you are too.
But they sound great.
Yeah. Yeah, they're a good sounding kit. But let's see. Let's do our snare top. And so for the verb, I'm just using this.
That guy.
Yeah, it's like a fake thing. I like the kind of ratty, kind of crappy verb on snare for some reason. If it's like too nice, I feel like you have to turn it up too loud.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like I just kind of like this kind of, just some like digital plate, FG250, whatever that is. You guys probably know. I'm sure it's like an old lexicon unit or something, but yeah, it's kind of. A little bit there. Usually won't do the bottom. Do some of this trigger in there. nice.
All right, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
So whenever I, like, if I'm soloing out drums and I put, like, a sweet reverb on the snare and I get it sounding great, then I pull it into the mix, I feel like the reverb just kind of disappears.
Yeah.
So what do you do to combat that?
Turn it up when you mix. So right now I just like to hear how this, since I have so many different individual drums going to it, how the snare top sounds going in it, broad range of that.
Okay.
How the snare sample sounds going in it, kind of broad range of that, maybe those together. And then, you know, I don't have any guitars or anything in here yet. So as that comes in, then you can adjust, okay, I can't hear the verb at all or vice versa.
Right.
Well, I really went over. But usually you're right. Usually it's the earlier of like, oh, I didn't add enough of this. Because when you're solo, it's like, oh, that's too much verb.
Right.
But then in a mix, you can't hear it.
Right.
And I usually end up not doing a lot just because I have these room samples going here.
Right.
Which you can kind of hear.
Sounds a little bit larger than our room here.
Yeah, definitely. So that's kind of like a fake thing. I have that, and then I'm, for some reason, I had this mono one. And I don't know why, but I did it on the mix, and I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. So it's in there.
Dragon Ship Studio says, I have a PCM 60 from the 80s that I love on snares for that same reason.
Nice.
And he says, to use a nasty verb.
Yeah.
What's the nastiest verb you can think of?
The SP90, the Yamaha guy?
I was going to say a four-letter word. That's the nastiest verb that I can think of.
Oh, verb.
But that's a verb and not so much a reverb.
Yeah.
That's neither here nor there, though.
Neither near nor there.
Yep.
Words. I'm gonna bring the snare room just with the soloed snare so you can kind of hear what it's doing.
Okay.
But just listen for like the side, you know, the stereo stuff. It's easy to overdo because it sounds so cool.
Right.
But with that, you don't really need a ton of verb.
But it does sound great, though.
Yeah. And then this mono sample here. All right. Boom. All right. Bass, finally. Jeez. We're out of drums for now.
And we'll still go back and like revisit stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And adjust as we go.
Yep, for sure. I'm definitely probably going to have to do some more like broad EQ strokes on some stuff.
Okay.
Make stuff brighter. So first I have this amp that I'll kind of bring in, show you guys. This is the bass.
Is this all stuff that you reamped?
Yeah. So this is they sent me just a DI. He may have sent me an amp track. I can't remember, but I just basically reamped this DI. And this is actually through just like a setting of plugins that I used.
Okay.
I have this bass tone that I love. It's like a combination of like a bias guitar amp, a bias like orange amp, like a bass amp.
Okay.
And then some different like Ampeg cab IRs and basically just a hodgepodge. And I knew like obviously we wouldn't have all of those here to recreate it. So I just bounced it down. But yeah, I love the sound of it. And so I kind of split my bass up for like a sub and then a high-end bass, which is pretty typical in metal.
Ken says Fab Filter yep. Saturn is incredible on bass.
Yeah, I use that. That's what's on the top end of this. Basically, once I got the amp sound and everything through that orange, I just, you know, do the top end of like saturation. And you get that.
Cool.
Yeah. But first, I'm going to build this low-end track. Which is this is just their DI.
Okay.
You see, it's like a little kind of ratty and high-endy, but there's some good low-end information hidden in there. So usually I kind of compress it a little bit first. So that just kind of makes it more consistent, keeps it pinned down. And then we'll go into this, the classic Sans amp, everyone on Pro Tools.
Yep.
And is this plugin even available not on Pro Tools?
I don't think so. It's definitely a stock plugin.
Yeah. I've never seen it anywhere else. although I haven't really used a bunch of different DAWs, but yeah, this thing's just classic. But this is just my low end track, so I'm not really worried about the grit since I'm kind of getting that from my other one.
Right.
But I kind of use this buzz. This buzz is like a low end kind of thing. You can kind of hear that there. And then we will grab the old stock EQ here, and I'll kind of create a crossover.
Oh, woof.
Woof.
Look at that thing.
This is so pretty.
But it works great, though.
Yeah, it really does.
It really is a great EQ.
I mean, stock EQs, you can get done with whatever, you know, whatever you need. So I'll kind of just do like a filter like that where we just have the low end now. And then I will also use this thing. There's a bunch of different, like Waves Max Bass is one that I use a lot. But basically it just creates a resonant, more resonant low end. You do have to be careful with it though, because you pick like a specific frequency. Max Bass is the same way. It does like a kind of a broader range. But if you go too much with it, when your bass changes notes, obviously those note changes are different frequencies.
Right.
So it could just get lost sometimes. So you can't just rely on this solely for the low end, but I do love using this to kind of beef it up. You guys will hear that here. See just how much more low end that adds.
And that's just the DI, right?
Yeah, that's just the DI. But with this, it kind of creates a really solid, extreme's a little too high. I'll probably just do.
Okay.
Yeah, just a nice girthy subs, you know, and we'll kind of, there, it does introduce a little bit too much low end down in the really, really low, low stuff, but we'll take care of that on the bus. And then from there, usually I'll just limit this guy and call him good.
I mean, what else do you do if you're just using the low end of the bass DI anyways? I mean,
yeah.
What else do you really need to do?
Right. Once we go in a little later, I'll get to that as far as just like I'll basically sidechain the kick to just this low end.
Right.
That way when our kick's hitting, it kind of ducks it a little bit.
Just the low end of it, but yep, the bass is still punching through.
Yeah, just the low end. So if, you know, if you do that on the bus, then like it ducks your high end and it's way more noticeable. And it,
yeah,
once double kicks get in there, it gets nasty. It's not fun.
Okay.
But if you just do the low end, it's like, okay, you're good to go.
So I've been doing it across the entire bus.
Yeah, dude.
Right now.
The high end. So that's kind of,
I'm not dealing with as much like double kick as you are.
That's
so
true.
I don't know how much of a difference that would make, but it makes sense what you're
it's
saying.
Still, yeah, I think you could still benefit from it. But yeah,
I could see like if you have like a double kick going, it's just going to be ducking the bass constantly.
Yeah, it does. And it gets bad.
Okay, cool.
So let's kind of, I do just limit it as well, so we'll kind of do that real quick.
Don't even worry about compressing it, just smash the shit out of it.
So kind of adjust that release to keep it from farting out, which is pretty common with the low end trying to do this.
Kenton says it's one thing he still needs to learn to get right, sidechaining and ducking the bass with the kick.
Yeah.
Which I think is super important.
Yeah.
Because they both take up such low frequencies, and
yep,
low frequencies get muddy so quickly. But both things are so important to a great mix.
Yep.
That you got to get them to get along with each other.
Yeah.
And I do think it takes more than just a little EQ sculpting.
It does. But then sometimes it doesn't, which is weird.
That's true.
That's what's so weird. Because like actually on this original mix, I don't think I did that. And like that was one thing the band
still was, this for a second.
Yeah, you're good. The band was really stoked on like the low end. And but I didn't, I just kind of did the sculpting to where like, okay, my bass, I'll sit around 80. I want a really fat kick, so I'll dip it around 60 and I'll just put my kick in that 60 null. And it worked okay, but if you do it this way and do it lightly to where it's just a little bit of dipping, it's not that bad. We'll do that real quick though, just so you can see, Kenton. Usually I use
I
like
to pee.
Go, Rick has to
dude,
pee
I
again.
Broke the seal.
Dude, I have to pee
like
really
nonstop.
Bad too. When you get back, you can
right, we'll
talk, and then I'll
out.
Go
we'll
pee.
Swap it out. Let's swap it out.
But
see,
usually I use the R comp, the Waves one for this, but I'll try it with this stock compressor, and then if we slide over here to my kick drum, on my kick trig, I have this sidechain send setup. Kind of turn that on there, turn that up, and then we'll set the key input here. Well, let's see, kick sidechain right there, and then again. So now you see right there, that's the kick kind of dipping in and out coming from this fader. And you can fine tune it even more over here. So this is just letting me hear the sidechain coming in. And this again is on my bass sub. So you fine tune over here, and what I can do is I can roll off some of that high end of the kick drum to where now only the low end of the kick drum is affecting what's going to my bass bus, which normally wouldn't matter since it's a sample. But once we go into later on in the song, once I start doing the automation, I'll kind of roll off some of the low end on that, which then also means that that low end isn't going to be affecting this sidechain as much. So I usually only roll it off on really fast, like 32nd note kick parts or 16th note kick parts, where that's when it would get real noticeable on your sidechain. But by focusing just on that low end, when I roll that low end up, less of it's going to be coming to this, so my bass will be less affected and it gets less wobbly with that double kick. Kind of set the release up a little faster, a little higher ratio just so it ducks it a little more. You hear it kind of farting out there a little bit. We can smooth the knee and that'll help it. Now we can kind of bring in the kick and hear how it's... Yeah. Feeling pretty good about that. And again, I kind of adjust the low end. You'll be adjusting the low end the whole mix. So let's bring in this high, kind of high bass now. So basically I kind of do the same thing, but the opposite. So I roll off, I want the big guy. I roll off kind of the low end on this and just use the high end. So yeah, let's roll off some of the low end on this high guy. Hi, guy.
Hey, guy.
Oh, hi, Mark. So you can kind of hear that. So basically, this is just our high bass here. And we did need to flip the phase on that because you heard when I did that, I kind of popped into focus a little stronger. Even though we're cutting out the low end, it still helps. And then, let's see, I'll kind of do some EQing on this, kind of get rid of some of the nasties. So you can kind of hear what that's doing, but I feel like it could be a little bit nastier. It can always be a little nastier.
You can never be too nasty with bass.
No.
Unless you're too nasty with the bass.
Right. Then you're too nasty with the bass. I'm going to compress this one a little more with this same guy. Actually, let me get rid of some of that high end, because I think that's also making this. All right, so for nasty on bass, I like to do the decapitator.
Okay. Which is an awesome plugin.
Oh, love this plugin. So just kind of go through and listen to, I guess these are like the different style or characteristics. So I always just kind of go through and listen to which one brings out some high-end stuff I like. And then we can dial it back here and also kind of fine-tune some of the other parameters. So I'm going to play that and do that. You can kind of mix it in a little bit. So let's listen to that with the low end. So again, I do that Brit in because its low end is awesome. And so pretty much drums and bass always get that. Got a nice low end. And then I like this FGN on this actually. So I'll kind of use this to cut off some of the sub lows. And this thing kind of has a bump that goes along with it. So as you roll stuff off, you'll actually hear some other low end get added, which is always fun. And then, okay, I really got to pee. All right, let's. We're here on the bass bus, so we're gonna dial in this a little bit.
All right,
dial it in.
This is the bass bus.
Let's bring out a little bit of mid-range there and. So even though I compressed the bass there and there and limited there,
mm-hmm.
I still hitting it a little more.
I mean, it makes sense though.
Yeah,
you want to lay that foundation. You want it to be thick
juicy
and you want it to just sit there.
All right. We'll start with that. We'll obviously kind of mess with some of the levels as we go. Let's get to the guitars. Finally.
What guitars, what amp are we using for this? Do we
know? So I actually use that 5153 that we have for both of these.
Okay.
But different cabs.
I noticed Chris TGI posted a couple weeks ago about how you made one of his favorite 5153 amp profiles.
Yeah. So it's you remember those DI profiles I did?
Mm-hmm.
It was taking one of those DIs and I merged them with a cab from an older profile.
Okay.
And so honestly, and this was even before that, before we even released it, I used that one of those in the mix.
Cool.
So the right guitar is that merge profile, and then the left guitar is the 5153 with our with my Mesa cab.
I feel like I really need to get a 5153.
Yeah, they're fun.
They're inexpensive.
Oh yeah.
And they're just great amps, and they're pretty versatile.
Yeah, you can literally do, I mean, metal, rock for the most part.
You could do Whitney Houston, Boyz II Men. Hitney Houston, any of it.
Yeah.
Did you call her Hitney?
Hitney Houston. Yeah, right?
It's too soon for that, man.
Oh, no. Yeah, probably. My bad. All right, guitars.
All right.
Pull out some fizzies and some nasties.
Mm-hmm. So you're just looking at like what's like popping through the most right there?
Kind of, yeah. I actually didn't have this frequency analyzer when I originally did it. I think I used Q10, which doesn't have that.
Okay.
But on mine, I remember it was like a 3200 and like a 4K. But on this, it's kind of nice being able to see, like...
Are you just kind of looking at, like, what, like, that one transient that's, like, popping out there?
Yeah, like, I was just looking, like, okay, I'll try that. I actually, on mine, like I said, I ended up going, like, up here.
Are you using different cabs on the left and right?
Yeah.
What's the purpose of that?
Stereo separation.
Okay.
So, like, I, you know...
So, same amp, but different cabs.
Same amp, different cabs. That way, I feel like using the same cabs on both sides, you know, you kind of get that buildup overall.
Sure.
Or if you can find a right cab that complements the left cab, or what I've been doing actually recently is just doing a different blend of speakers. So yeah. I may have the same cab, but where left cab, I do vintage 30 with like a little bit of G12 in there.
Okay.
The right cab, I'll do G12 with a little bit of vintage 30.
And it's crazy. Like, and I've talked about this a little bit, but like a lot of high gain amps sound very similar.
Yeah.
But the speakers make so much more a difference.
Oh yeah.
We kind of found that out together, right?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, when anytime you go through like a profiling session or where you're just bouncing back from heads with high gain stuff, you really start to notice like
they're very similar.
Does it, you know, at this point, like really any of these could work,
right?
But what I also found too is you can't just throw the mics up and then bounce around heads, which is you know it's kind of cool to throw a mic up and then get your head and then adjust the mics to that head. But then put another head on and then kind of adjust the mics to, okay, what does this accentuate in this head that I like more or something, you know?
Sure.
It's just it's a big rabbit hole. I feel like you could spend tons of time on guitar tone.
That's a tough time. That's a tough thing too, is that I feel like, whenever I'm tracking, I feel like I wish that I had a day, to just explore guitar tones and to be able to like, this is going to be like the rhythm side, maybe left. This is going to be rhythm side right. Yeah. This is going to be our lead. Because you're right. Like there's so much that goes into it besides just the amp.
Yeah. So I guess Mock Audio, you're asking about the different cabs left and right. If you balance them right, it won't really get lopsided. There's definitely going to be more frequency buildup of whatever cab. But it's like going through like this, obviously don't put the exact same EQ on each cab. You're going to adjust it a little differently. So you just keep your low end and stuff in check. That way it doesn't feel like you're being pulled one way or the other. And if you can do that, you can have different characteristics and not feel lopsided. As long as you're just like I said, if there's like a ton low end in the right and like not very much low end, then obviously like you're going to pull this way. But, you can use different cabs, different guitars, different heads. Different guitars is really awesome. Cause you really get that separation.
That's true.
Cause they're not,
I feel like sometimes guitars, and again, I feel like different guitars make more of a difference than different heads sometimes.
It could, yeah, for sure. Like, yeah, like a 5153, a 6505, Engel Powerball. Like, switching between those three, you're pretty much, you know, you're in the ballpark with all three of them.
They all sound very similar.
Yeah. All right, let's keep going with this old guitar fun. So I don't know, you guys can hear that. And these guitars have a ton of low end in them too. I think he used like Juggernauts or Aftermaths or one of those, but there's just a ton of low end. So kind of cleaning that up. And then I'll drag that over to this right guitar. But obviously, like I said, since we're doing a different cab, we'll kind of change it. So yeah, you can kind of hear what that's doing there. Just kind of pulling out some of those nasties. This ride guitar was a little darker, so I'm just kind of boosted a little bit of high, you know, 6K in there just to get it matched. That way it's not so lopsided, but there's still a different characteristic within each. And then we'll come over here to the bus of those guitars and we'll kind of EQ some individual stuff.
It's already starting to sound like super sick, dude.
Yeah, it's coming together. I like this bomber on the guitars too.
What do you like about it?
Just kind of the saturation it adds.
I feel like bomber's cool, like bringing things to the front.
Yeah, it definitely, yeah, it's got a nice texture. You can go over with it, but I go to a different part of the song. So at this point, I'd probably like put some of my mix bus stuff on. I kind of got guitars, bass, and drums in. All right, so yeah, we got our balance of drums, bass, guitars. So now I'll go down here and I'll set up kind of some broad mix bus stuff.
Do you mix like your instruments and your vocals differently? Do you set them to different?
Yeah,
like...
so you see here I have a mix bus and then I have the Vox mix bus.
Okay.
Which is, yeah, it's just basically a different... Just because like I don't want... Obviously, this is going to be smashed with music. I think you started doing that too recently. Like,
I did, because I felt like vocals were like dipping.
They start to duck if like the snare's hitting it or yeah.
Yep.
Yep, you got to watch out.
I felt like my vocals are so loud, I felt like my vocals were dipping my music.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I guess pop punk, you have to have those like sitting on top of everything.
I mean, you shouldn't, but it seems like it does.
Yeah.
And so like I felt like, excuse me, that's a big old burp. Whoop. I feel like when I'm doing stuff, like when I was sending everything to just one mix bus, that my vocals were dipping stuff before even the snare would hit it, which is crazy because usually the snare is like louder
like
than
smashing.
Everything.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah. So like I just did that. I still send stuff to like, I still send stuff so that like instruments and vocals are still getting compressed together after the fact.
Okay.
But I'm like, I got an instrument bus, I've got a vocal bus, and then very lightly I'll smash the two together.
Cool. Yeah. Yeah, I'm just going to play this and then we'll kind of mess with this compressor a little bit and then this EQ on the bus as well.
What compressor is this?
So this is the Vertigo VSC. It's okay. A VCA compressor. It's honestly similar to the Serpent. It's like your SSL quad VCA style.
Okay.
It's got the sidechain filter where you can roll off, not actually roll off, but basically the detector, you know, it's not influenced by the low end kick,
which I feel like is super important.
Yeah, for metal there's so much kick drum, you don't have that pumping everything else.
Yeah,
so I'll kind of use that. The Serpent has a really cool one that's variable, which I'm sure you used if you're using that for drums,
right? Same thing, like my I'm using the MBP for my instrument bus, and same thing there, where I'll throw on like the low pass, not a low pass filter, but like
the
it's,
detector
it's,
yeah
the detector,
side chain. Yeah,
yeah, because I don't want it squashing the low end,
right? Yeah. So yeah, we'll kind of play this and then I'll dial this a little bit.
Cool.
Cool. So that's sitting all right. Fast or slow attack, fast release, you know.
Yep.
4-to-1. I either do 4-to-1 or 10-to-1 usually.
That's a big jump.
Nowhere in between.
Wow.
Or nowhere below.
Cool.
I feel like all this is just...
I feel like 4-to-1 is usually my sweet spot. That's really interesting that you would jump to maybe 10-to-1.
Yeah. Like for the mix, I mean, like sometimes it sounds cool.
Yeah.
Like, just a little punchy. It's pretty subtle, though, you know.
Maka Audio says, another use for the multi-band. I sidechained the main mix bus to the Vox bus to the music ducts when the vocals come in. Obviously, a very small amount. That's cool. I do it with guitars, because I feel like guitars are the one thing that, like, really sits in the same frequency as vocals.
Yeah.
But, I mean, like, I don't think it's going to be much. I think if you do it across the entire mix bus, you're essentially achieving the same thing where you're ducking just the one frequencies.
Yeah.
Maybe. I don't know. I haven't tried it. That makes sense, though.
All right. And then we got this little EQ. I'm just going to do some broad stuff on the mix. I try not to go too crazy, but... Or do I?
I like EQ across the mix anyways, because I feel like I feel like EQing across the mix really kind of helps kind of glue things together even more.
Yeah.
Just a little bit.
Well, I can already tell I want to go...
It's such a stupid term.
I know.
Oh, it's glued together. It's so warm and musical, dude. Dude, you hear that, man?
Yeah.
Dude, that's so warm.
What tubes are those?
We're stupid. You know, I already hear stuff that I want to go back and make brighter, so...
Right.
If I can get a broad kind of thing of it, I'll do it here.
Oh yeah, it's real musical.
So you can kind of hear me. I just took everything off the mix. You kind of hear how it's settling everything in.
Uncle Jesse says, he points to himself saying, mastering engineer, got him raffling on the floor. He's like, that's basically my job, right? Tube, bro. Actually, I think that the job of a mastering engineer is to make the mix engineer feel like shit. Oh, it's just to make us feel incompetent. Like we're not worthy to touch music. And that you're doing us a favor and basically taking the shit that we've created and making it like so it's just barely listenable. And we're lucky. We're lucky to have that. And we should be thankful.
We should.
If I'm working with a mastering engineer and I don't feel like shit, I don't think I've got my money's worth. You know what I mean?
you need to swap your mastering engineer out, I guess.
Maybe. I feel like if I'm dealing with a mastering engineer, if I get an email back from the mastering engineer and I'm not like on the floor in the fetal position, that I've done something wrong. It's somewhere along the lines.
Called master for a reason. That's the truth. Your boy.
Listen, chaboy, this is what happens. We grant you the spot on the Jedi Council, but we're not giving you the rank of master.
Not yet.
Little Star Wars reference there.
There you go.
Not an exact quote. I butchered it. But
you tried.
I did try. Except there is no try. It's do or do not, yeah, right?
There you go.
We've had a lot of beer today.
You have. I'm on my first one because I'm trying to, you know, keep some fresh air.
Well,
going
some of here. Us are professionals and some of us aren't.
Well, some of us are hanging out, just heckling everyone.
I'm not heckling anybody. <I know. laughs>
All right. Maybe we should play the song from the beginning because I've just kind of been jumping around.
Yeah, let's hear where we
let's
are.
Let's actually
with it.
Mix the song.
Let's hear where we are at this point.
I'm going to start bringing in some of these leads because I haven't yet.
Is this The Who? P.S. I have to pee again. I think it's crazy how much the bass makes this mix.
Yeah, the bass is like super loud right now, but I
no,
don't,
but it sounds great.
I
though.
Don't hate it.
No, it sounds awesome.
So we got this little, it's kind of like a little lead thing. And then I'm sending it to this Echo Boy and a D-verb. It's basically just a parallel send. It affects send for guitars. I'll use that or H-delay. Ole Borud, everybody. Dude is an insane guitarist. All right, so, and for leads, usually I'll do like an L1 limiter again, just to keep them focused. We don't have L1, so we'll use this bad boy. Yeah, this dude freaking rips. He's so good at guitar. And that's one of the reasons why Extol was my favorite band. He was the lead player in Extol, you know, and he wrote a lot of those riffs and stuff too. But another reason why I was super stoked to mix this, because as a guitarist, some of the stuff is just absolutely insane.
Ooh, by the way, huh? By the way.
Did you fart on your way in the room?
It's so terrible. Oh my gosh.
I smelled you before I see.
I farted and I was like, you know what? It's going to be fine. It's not going to smell. It's not a big one. And I was horribly wrong.
It was a big one.
Oh, whew. So sorry.
That's all right. We'll make it.
Those beer farts, man.
That gum.
I am a professional in as much that I do this for a living. Outside of that, there's nothing pro going on here. And I apologize, Jack.
Why do you apologize, dude? For? I don't. Oh, for the fart.
That's the Chick-fil-A coming through from lunch.
Ooh, that was rough.
It still is rough.
Yeah. I just kind of balance some of these little leady boys.
Are those center left or right panned? How are we panning these guys?
Yeah, just hard left.
They all look like stereo tracks,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, hard left and right.
How did you, okay, let me ask you this. How did you get stereo tracks on these leads?
Well, some of them he sent, and then...
Are they recording them with two different mics and like panning them?
Oh,
like,
no. So basically, like, you would, you know, you have your amp sound, but you would run it through like a Strymon or something that will turn that mono into stereo.
Okay.
And then run that in the Pro Tools. So technically, like, you still hear the lead is in the center, even though I have it panned left and right.
You're right.
And just the effect of that lead.
But there's a little bit of a wobble going on there, right?
Like,
Well, I mean, like, it's not like you just take, like, and you pan it left and right, and then it's just dead center. Because if you're looking at the waveform, like, there's something going on there that's, like, making it, like,
yeah, and that's
not...
kind of the effect, like, the reverb and stuff that's on there in delay.
Okay.
Yeah. But like if you're sitting over here, you could hear that. Like just the lead picking is just in the center. It's only one guitar track being played.
Right.
The effect of it is stereo,
though. Okay.
And so yeah, you see a little bit of push and pull on the left and right.
I dig that.
And then this was just an effect here.
It still smells in here too.
Yeah, it's still going on, guys. No one's safe.
We're fighting through though. Sounds fucking sick, man. A lot of it too is just that, like, the music is fucking cool. So what are you listening for right now? Like, what are you, you're making some small adjustments. Like, what are you listening to as you're listening to the mix?
I'm just kind of trying to detach from, like, the small things that I've been doing this whole time. I kind of got a balanced set, but just now, just listening as a whole, like, okay, my snare could use a little more attack. It's kind of a little ratty in some places. I think it's, you know, maybe this top mic or bottom mic. And so now I'm just kind of going back to big picture stuff.
Okay.
So I'm just going
to... Like making small adjustments while listening to things as a whole.
Right, because pretty much things are set. I just need to kind of, you know, last 5 or 10%. And I don't want to try to go in and really dig deep because I've already done that. I just kind of want to listen and balance, you know, balance everything.
What's sticking out to you at this point? Because as I listen to it, I'm just like, that sounds pretty fucking great.
Yeah, there's, it's just small stuff. Like I said, like I heard like some kind of rattiness in the snare. I think it could be this top mic. I was going to come down here, kind of balance in... the snare was a little dry sounding, so I brought up some of that room.
Some of the reverb?
Yeah, okay. some of the room.
In the room, okay.
Yeah, and I may, sometimes I'll send that room to this other smash, so I'm going to kind of work on that a little bit, because I'm not really hearing that, which is, you know, it's a good thing. It's definitely adding something, but I feel like some of the...
What are you not hearing?
Like the stuff around the drums, I think if I sent that to this kind of smash that I have...
Okay, might bring it out just a little bit
more. Yeah, just a little bit, kind of, you know, encompassing the room and everything going in.
Okay.
So I'm just going to play that and kind of play through this.
Okay.
This is always fun. We'll see just how far off the mark we are.
It still sounds... What are you checking?
I have the original mix.
Oh, the original mix. Okay.
Which is probably a bad idea, but
no,
it would be
fun.
No, I
think it's a great idea.
Nailed it.
Dude, I think it sounds fucking great.
Yeah, it doesn't sound bad. I mean, in this room, it could be because I mix in this room, but I'm happier with where it's sitting now than I am with the old mix. But again, I've never mixed in this room, so who knows in the real world what that's like.
But they're very close, though.
Yeah, it's not like night and day. you know, you can just hear some different things.
But I mean, like, that's gonna be like that anytime that you, like, even if you're sitting in your own room and you're approaching everything from scratch, you're right. gonna mix it differently every time.
Yeah.
But I still I think it sounds like very, very similar.
Right, yeah. It's not
all things considered, like in a different room, on different monitors, with different plugins, we're still getting like really close.
And like a beer in me.
And a beer in me.
Yeah, and a beer in me. Let's bring in some vocals.
All right. Wait, okay, I have a question. Yeah. And this is mostly in general. Yeah. What are metal guys so upset about? Like, why are they always complaining about? Like, it's just like they're always just like, just screaming about stuff. Like, what do they have to be so sad about?
Because, I mean, they have nothing.
They're just so angry all the time.
That's what my grandma says every Christmas. I like what you're doing, but what's your singer so mad about? Still doing that music thing?
That's the most like deflating question. Yeah,
still doing that music thing, Grandma. Yeah, Mama. Oh, he's trying.
That's a generation thing. Let me tell you something. This slate, like the Alesia, or I'm sorry, the Elosis De-esser.
I hate it.
Really?
Dude, I hate it.
Dang.
I hate it so much. We watch the mandate of humanity. I feel like no matter what I do, it either is like not working, or it like it just grabs things so hard that things just sound like really bad. But you're dealing with like scream vocals, scream box.
Yeah. I feel like this thing, if you on the default settings, kind of annoying that like high boost there.
Yeah.
As far as like the de-esser of it.
I just can't. For me, it's like it either grabs things too hard or not hard enough, and it just, I hate it. We feel the paralyzing
consequence. All right, and then I got these verb synths here. I can kind of show you guys what those are doing. Basically, you got a Vox verb. Pretty normal. Rich Vox. Sounds like we may need to roll off a little bit of low. I already did. Maybe a little more.
Mod Lord J. Fraser says, I've yet to find a decent tutorial that shows how that de-essers work. Laugh out loud. I can't figure it out. Hey, you and me neither, buddy. I have no idea. I just slap it on there. I'm like, well, that sucks. And I take it off. I'm like, well, that also sucks. And then I just like burn the whole studio down.
Yeah. Basically, a de-esser is just like a multi-band compressor, but they usually only have one band. And that's, you center it in on the sound. That really bright, you know, when you say S's. And so where it just activates when someone says S, that way it doesn't, so sibilant.
Sibilant.
Oh, yeah, so I had an Echo Boy Jr. on this delay throw, but...
You're just going to have to throw a regular Echo Boy on there.
I guess, yeah, I guess I'll have to dial something in from scratch.
Ugh. Uncle Jesse, you might as well be John Stamos as far as I'm concerned, man.
In our eyes, you are.
Absolutely. We'll all never, day, every day.
We'll never tell you anything different.
Nope.
I think I had that on like a... There we go. Do a little high cut and then maybe do a little ping pong.
Ooh, I love a little ping pong.
Except let's turn this one up.
What are you going to set it to? Yeah.
There it is. Now let's saturate it. And then there's like some fun stuff in here too. Echoplex. To gain.
to gain. He's so angry.
Yeah. Yeah, he is. So basically, I already have the automation for that.
It's hard to like get the anger across, though, when it's not echoing. Like, if it's just like a dry anger, like, you don't really get it. But you really get that feel when you're ping-ponging.
When you're ping-ponging. So this track here I have called the, you know, it's delay throw. And basically, I just have it on a fader here. And on certain words, I'll just ride it up. And another cool thing is you could just have another track that you could just drag a word up and drop it in.
That's true.
Another way to do it. Super easy. This, you know,
I hate automation.
Yeah, so you probably would do that. You probably drag the words.
No, I was gonna say, like, I don't mind like doing like on the last like little vocal right there. If it's just like a little bit of automation right there and it's just a send, I'll do that. But I do hate automation. I mean, automation is great.
Yeah.
I just hate dealing with it.
I think on my long delay, I went pretty crazy. There's my long delay automation.
Oh my gosh.
So they really wanted, they were really particular about their delays, more so than any band ever is.
Apparently.
No one really ever cares. They're like, whatever, it sounds wet. But which is, it's awesome though. It honestly pushed me more because Ole, he's really particular about his delays of timing and everything. So I really went above and beyond in this and kind of just, I would basically just ride the fader through every song on this long delay here.
We need to get you like an avid artist mix so you can like
that'd be fun for riding. Yeah,
8-finger like ride that thing.
Yeah, I'm all about riding faders and overheads and all that stuff to kind of give the song movement, especially metal. It's easy to just get so stagnant. So like riding faders, like a, you know, at the beginning of a chorus, loud cymbals, duck
that,
down.
This kind of automation stresses me out a little bit.
But dude, it's really not that bad. You just set this to basically, you can set it to touch or latch.
That looks like setting it to cancer to me.
No, you can just set it to latch. That way, every time you let go of the knob, it goes back to where you have it set. And so, like, and that you could just play through the song and ride a passage. And if you didn't like how you do, you could do it again. It's definitely like a fun way to kind of, because it kind of puts you in the music a little more because you're almost playing your own instrument, you know?
That's bullshit.
It is therapeutic.
No, that's bullshit.
Yeah, no, it is.
No, it's bullshit.
No, it is. It's like a fun, like, I love that part of the mix where like everything's there. I can just ride the faders. I put on, you know, I put on some incense, light some candles. I don't know about that mix, guys. That was painful. The one guy just yelled the whole time while the nice guy was trying to work. I don't know what was going on.
I have to pee so bad. No. Dude, I'm tired of peeing.
So I think the technical automation sucks. Where like
Automation sucks
when you're fixing problems, when you have to go in like, oh, I have to automate this low end. I have to automate this.
Right.
You know, you got to automate the ride track. You got to automate the ghosties. That part of automation sucks.
Yeah.
This side of automation is definitely more, you literally just play the song.
Okay, but here's my argument.
Twitch band incoming.
No doubt. I mean, we all know that it's incoming at some point. Here's my thing. I'm like, listen, if you want delay more on one part than on another, then why don't you just sing it like that?
Nothing just to get play,
it right,
play.
Just get it right at the source. Why do I have to sit there and ride this fader to your liking?
Get it right at the source.
That's right. I'm just trying to bring us back centered after all of you guys got off the rails about automation. I'm trying to bring the stream back to like...
Bring it back home, Rick. Bring it back home.
I'm trying to. It's just really difficult.
All right. We got some doubles here to play with. All right, then we got these Ole vocals, which I love. He does a very cool, like, yes thing. You guys listen to classic rock. Kind of bring in some of the synths and stuff here.
Are those natural harmonies? Did he sing those or did you create those?
No, he sang all those.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah, he's really awesome at just layering like cool proggy vocals. So he's doing this death metal band, but he's actually like a famous pop singer in Norway.
Okay.
He's on the like Norwegian version of like Dancing with the Stars right now as like one of the stars.
Which is on Dancing with Our Stars?
Yeah, like but like their version of it, the Norwegian like Dancing with the Stars.
Okay.
Cuz he's really just a big just pop singer over there, but he also like shreds and plays tech death, which is really cool.
Okay. It does have a hint of classic rock.
So the thing I did kind of differently with these doubles as opposed to like the scream doubles, you kind of see all these screams are ran to this double bus and I have the compressor kind of there. But then on all these kind of singing harmonies, I compress them all individually because like different parts would duck basically if I tried to compress on the bus.
Yep.
So I kind of already have them all set up for each individual part. That way it's just, you know, they don't get squashed when like...
Were layers. The vocals compressed on the way in at all? Do you
yeah,
know?
Yeah, so I did. I did on
Well,
the,
I mean, you didn't track them. When they were tracked, were they
compressed
I did
track,
at all?
I did track these.
Oh, that's right. You did track
yeah,
them.
The scream. So,
okay.
So I compressed, and that's why you'll see I have my distressor here on like the opto setting.
Yep.
So I compressed them with 1176 on the way in.
Yep.
So I'm kind of just doing that classic 1176 LA2A thing.
Okay.
But I don't have an LA2A plugin on this system, so I just set up this distressor in opto mode, which is kind of like an LA2A.
Right.
And so that's kind of my second compressor.
How hard are you hitting the second? How hard did you hit the first compressor, and how hard are you hitting the second one?
The first one was like freaking slammed, like buried the needle on the 1176.
Okay.
Negative 20. And this one's like 4 or 5.
Okay.
It's not slammed.
A very slow attack, it looks like, right?
Yeah, really slow attack, really fast release. That's kind of the LA2A thing.
Right.
Whereas on my 1176, I already had the fast attack there to kind of tame stuff.
Okay.
A really fast compressor. So this is just doing the LA2 kind of...
Wait, so when you were tracking, did you attack with like a fast attack, fast release?
Yep. Yep. Exactly.
Okay.
Because 1176 is naturally a little bit faster.
Yep.
And then I forget where I had the settings.
Do you feel like it squashes it too much when you go super fast on the way in like that?
With cleans, I definitely have to back it down. But with screams, they're so...
I think like if you go fast attack, fast release on like an aggressive vocal, it just makes it a little more aggressive,
it
right?
It does, yeah. You get a lot of the, you know, it's clamping down really quick. Because screams are so basically just kind of dynamic compared to singing.
Right.
Because there's so much like different airflow kind of going through.
Right.
And it's already so saturated. So with clean vocals, I would probably back it. I wouldn't do quite as fast, but I would still do faster than like I would on a drum or like this, you know, on the LA2A side.
Okay.
But yeah, it's just kind of a flavor thing.
I'm going to go pee.
I also have to pee.
Dude, how many times have I gone pee so far?
Dude, it's been like 5 or 6.
No, it's been more than 5 or 6. It's been like 20 or 25.
My go-to setup for heavy vocals, I'll do for screams, SM7B. And then I have a purple audio biz or like the Neve 511 pre into the warm audio 1176. You know, fast release, mid to fast release, and then fast attack, or vice versa, mid to fast attack. Fast release. And then for clean vocals, I do like a Telefunken CU29, depending on the vocalist. Or I have like one of those Neumann like TLM somethings that are really cool for that stuff too.
All right, take us home, Daddy.
What's that?
I don't know, just put the faders up on the vocals and say that it's perfect.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think at this point I probably would just send it to the band and see, you know. Kind of go from there. We pretty much hit everything. There's like some production stuff up here that I added in that the band didn't even want. Like a lot of it, they were like, can you take that out? But a lot of it, they were cool that I left it. So I'll just pull that up real quick.
What kind of production stuff did you add?
Just like explosions. Just like
you can never have too many explosions. And they were like, they wanted that out?
And a couple of, you know, like...
Like reverse snares?
Yeah, like my typical kind of metal stuff that I do, but this is like a classic metal kind of almost.
Sure.
And I remember when I first sent it, he was like, there's like some kind of low-end thing going on. And I'm like, a sub drop? A sub dropper. So, yeah.
You didn't like the sub drop?
No.
Wow.
So I just, I mean, I put it pretty light, just an impactful thing.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that bass is pretty kicking, but whatevs.
No, it sounds rad.
Yeah, I'd probably just like send this to the band and then see what they think.
And I think, and I've talked a lot about that too, like not spending forever on a mix, on the initial
mix.
Not
the first mix, no.
Because you can sit there, we could be here for a month trying to make it perfect in our minds.
A month.
If we want, whatever amount of time.
Yeah.
We could be spending however long on a mix, on a first mix. And you're going to send it to the band, and the first thing the band's going to do is send it back with stuff they want changed.
That's why you just, you know, you always just mix like one song from the record, not the whole record, and get that feedback
going.
And
I don't even think worry about getting it perfect.
No. Yeah, because you know they're going to have something to come back on. So
always.
I'll spend like a couple hours, you know, we spent like 2.5 hours on this, but there was a lot of talking.
Right.
So it probably would have been done a lot quicker, and then I would send that and immediately get a feedback. And then I would know I didn't spend a day on it and then have to change, you know, like the guitar sound or something.
Right.
So like when I'm reamping, I always send like a reamp before I even mix. Like if I am mixing and I know I'm reamping, I'll just send the reamp like, hey, what do you think of this guitar tone?
Yeah.
And then I'll start the mix.
Let the band kind of guide it.
Or if there's MIDI drums, I'll send a MIDI drum kit like, hey, this is what I'm thinking for the source tone of that MIDI drums.
Right.
That way, if you mix it all and then they're like, yeah, we don't really like the snare sound. Not the sample, but like the actual drum from the MIDI.
Right.
Well, then you got to remix it because you built everything around that.
Absolutely.
So just getting that quicker feedback from the band. I think that's awesome.
And then if you have the CLA, if you have the CLA 10s, then
you're
just like
out the hits.
It's from mix one to mix done.
Just go ahead and name it that mix final. Send it to the band.
Yes.
No need to.
And if they come back, listen, if you're mixing on CLA 10s and a band comes back with mix notes, you just send them back a message that just says, wrong. You're wrong.
False.
Done.
You're false.
Absolutely. Is there anything else you want to do to this?
No.
I'm pretty bored with it.
Yeah,
in all honesty,
I feel like
I don't want to listen to this song ever again.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, this is where I would send it to the band. Like, there's nothing I could really do here.
I feel like you've ruined this song for me. Like, I've heard it so much at this point, I don't ever want to listen to it again.
You know, I would, I wouldn't.
I was going to buy it on iTunes, but it's like, I've already heard it a million times, so I don't need to buy it now. So not only am I tired of it, but now you're costing the band like sales.
And all we've done is listen to the intro and the guitar solo. I haven't even went to the chorus yet.
That's fine. Guys, this was super fun.
Heck yeah.
Let's clap it up in chat for Jack for being here. A tremendous talent. Like I said, highly untapped talent. And listen, if you guys do metal and you need somebody to mix your project, like Jack's the dude. On top of that, if you need somebody to record the project, Jack is very much the dude as well. I hope that you guys have enjoyed. I hope that you guys have learned something. I know I have learned something, but most of you guys know that I like got my YouTube degree and I'm in the continuing education portion of that degree. Jack, anything that you want to say, like to like take the people out?
No, just thanks for hanging around. You know, pretty much everything has been said. It's been a blast. This is my first time ever streaming anything, you know, or showing anyone any of my mixes. So, it was definitely fun for me and a cool experience. You guys have been awesome with the questions and everything. So looking forward to doing it again, and we'll do some tracking stuff too. We'll be here tracking a record not too long. So maybe we can do some drum setup and stuff like that.
I think that would be a lot of fun.
Yeah, we'll definitely keep the cameras rolling, and you know, thank you guys again.
Other than that, guys, this has been a fun stream. Again, thank you guys for hanging out. Do me a favor, Jack, wave to the people as we go out.
score.